गुरु ब्रह्मा गुरु विष्णु गुरु देवो महेश्वर गुरु साक्षात परब्रह्म तस्मै श्री गुरुवे नमः। गुड मॉर्निंग टू ऑल। मायसेल्फ डॉक्टर दीक्षा मासिमाडे फ्रॉम द डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ पंचकर्म सेकंड ईयर पीजी स्कॉलर। आई टेक दिस वंडरफुल अपॉर्चुनिटी टू वेलकम यू ऑल टू द सेकंड वेबिनार ऑफ अवर कर्म साधना दैट इज ऑन प्रिंसिपल्स एंड प्रैक्टिसेस ऑफ स्नेहना बाय डॉक्टर चंद्र मौलेश्वरन सर। Firstly, I welcome our beloved principal, Dr. Saida Attar Fatima Madam, our chief advisor, Dr. Rashikar Ganige sir, our guest speaker, Dr. Chandra Molishwaran sir, our chief organizing secretary, HOD sir, Dr. Dabbasai Swami Kennedmar sir, and our coordinator, Dr. Rajesh Sugu sir, Shilpa Shriya Madam, and Trishala Madam. And I welcome you all participants to the session, this session. To say about Chandra Molishwaran sir, to say about him, sir is currently working as a professor and HOD in the department of Panchakarma. Professor in the department of Panchakarma, Ayurveda College, Coimbatore, Tamil Nadu. Visited more than 6 countries to conduct classes and seminars for foreigner students. Published various articles in national and international journals. Invited as a resource person in state level and national level seminars. To deliver speeches on different topics of Panchakarma. Worked in 3 to 4 institutions as HOD, tutor and Panchakarma physician consultant. Sir has completed his BMS from Jayendra Saraswati Ayurveda College, Chennai and PG from DGM Ayurveda Medical College, Gadag. For other participants, if you have any queries, you can put it in chat box over there. Thank you, sir. I over to you, sir. Please, sir. Please, sir.
Can you hear me, ma?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so I'm thankful to Dr. Swami Kendadamat for inviting me to deliver a topic on Snehana. So thank you all once again, for inviting me. So let us start the session. Did you get my PPT, ma?
Yes, sir. We are getting, sir.
So we'll go to next. The next slide is coming, ma?
No, sir. Only starting slide is coming, sir. Principles and practice of Snehana.
Okay. Just sorry about it, huh? Connecting. I shared it, ma. Once again. Are you not getting it, ma?
Only first slide is we are able to see, sir.
Yeah, now, ma.
Yes, sir. Coming, sir.
Now coming?
Yes, sir.
The second one?
Yes, sir. Now came, sir.
Okay. Thank you. So, once again, so today topic it about Snehana. So, Snehana, it consists of both Bahya and Abhyantara. It's a very huge topic. So, it's impossible to cover both Bahya and Abhyantara in 2 hours. So I will concentrate more on Abhyantara Sneha Prana because most of us will be knowing about Bahya Sneha and its mode of action, all those stuffs. Maybe some other day we can do that. So what is Sneha? And yesterday night I spoke to Dr. Swami, and all of you are PG scholars, and all of you are already would have studied so many things in
excuse me sir
yeah
sir make it full screen sir that slide
this slide ma
yes sir down sir. Down sir in down go for third option sir full screen down sir down no sir
now?
Down no down sir
oh this one huh?
Yes sir yes volume button
down
next to volume
volume button. Is okay ma
volume is okay sir next to volume button one icon is there no sir down sir down
just a second ma now can you see ma
no sir
are you can you able to see me
sir we are able to see you but not the slides sir
hello yes yes ma
hello sir sir in that next to volume button one icon will be there next to volume button okay.
Can you see me, ma?
Yes, sir. Now it's perfect, sir.
Okay. This technology. Okay. Right. So, we'll be covering today the, you know, Abhinder Snehavana. And yesterday, Dr. Swami, yesterday night, he called me and he said, you know, because most of you are well-versed in classical aspects, I know about, you know, Snehavana. So I'll touch a little bit more about you know, biochemistry and all the stuff. Okay. So basically, what do you mean by snehana? So it can be internal as well as external. Okay. So basically, according to Shabda Kalpadrumam, darshana sparshana sparshane apiva shravana bhashane apiva yatra dravati antaranno sneha iti kvatyate. So just by darshana or sparshana, if a person feels anxiousness or, you know, feeling like melting, you know, if a person feels like that, you know, that is, that feeling itself is called snehana. So even it can be like by anything, even if a boyfriend see a girlfriend or girlfriend see a boyfriend, or even you have a beautiful, you know, food or anything, you know, which is made out of nice ghee or other stuff. So if you, if it makes you melt, okay, so that is called snehana, okay, according to Shabda Kalpa Dhruma, okay. Okay, so basically, this the good sneha dravya must do kledana, because kledana is very, very important, okay, you know, for shodana. So without kledana of doshas, shodanas, shodana like, vamana or virechana cannot be done. So yasya kledane shakti, that's why Charkacharya used this particular word, yasya kledane shakti. So a dravya which possesses this kledana shakti alone can act as a sneha dravya, because you know, in especially before shodana, this kledana is, you know, those sneha dravyas possess so many different qualities, but this kledana quality is very, very important. Why? Because without this particular quality, you know, you cannot make the doshas or you cannot soften the doshas. So that is the reason why yasya kledane shaktihi, this particular word Charkacharya used, he never used, he didn't use yasya, you know, any other like yasya dharane shakti or nothing. He used this particular word because in order to achieve a proper shodhana, this kledana quality is very, very important. Because kledana only excites the doshas. Okay? So That is the so depends on which Snehadravya process more Kleyadhana Shakti, you know, that much easy. Okay, we can, I know that particular Dravya will be excellent. So more Kleyadhana Snehadravya, you know, you'll get more Shodhana effect. Okay, so and this Snehana always dealt first. Why? You know, it's clearly explained by so Charakacharya. Even Chakrapani explains. So wow, this Vata is the powerful dosha, and Snehana is the only tool to counteract that powerful Vata. That is the reason why Snehana is dealt first, before any other therapies. Okay, and you know importance of Snehana. So this Snehasaro Ayam Purushaha Pranascha Snehabhuishtaha Snehasadhyascha Bhavati. So Sushruta Chikitsa. So Sushruta, go to the extent and say, the Purusha are the entire creature, or the human beings are nothing but the Snehana alone. Okay. So and Pranascha Snehabhuishtaha. So this entire life revolves around this Snehadravya or Sneha quality. So Snehana is that much. This particular word or this sentence is very important because this particular importance is given only to Snehadravyas, not any other Dravyas. So not for Swayadana or anything. So Snehasaro Ayam Purusha, which is like says, in ultimately in one word, how important Snehana is. So you see, the entire universe is it revolves around the guna. So without guna pada or without guna, nothing. Even the treatment rasa vaisheshikam, if you see, in Kerala this book is available, maybe like translation might be also available. It is entirely that book, teaches you how to treat a disease simply with the help of gunas. So basically, the entire universe is made out of gunas, and the entire universe, revolves around the gunas. Okay, so among all the gunas, Snigdha guna is very, very important, because without Snigdha guna, there is no growth or no development of the Santarpana. Only happens through Snigdha guna. That's the reason why in olden days, sorry, in old day, when you are getting older, what happens? The Snigdhata goes down in the body, the Rukshata slowly takes in. So when there is more Rukshata, always Vata increases and always degeneration or Dhatu Shithilata takes place. So that is the reason why Snigdha guna is very, very important for growth and development. That's why when the baby is born, first and foremost, we give Ghritam in the in the mouth, especially because four things are Ajanma Shatam. Ghritam, Madhu, okay, then gold, okay, and milk. Okay, so that is the reason why first and foremost we give Ghritam. Why? Because Snigdhata is very, very important for growth and development and immunity. So in olden days, in old age, what happens? The Snigdhata goes down, the Rukshata sets in, so automatically, slowly we die. So Snigdha guna is that much important. Okay, so why is Snehapana is so much important than Swayadana or Dipanapachana? Because if you see the cardinal features of Samyak Snigdha Lakshanas are Vishyandana, Mardava, and Kleyadana of dosha. So without these three, without Vishyandana of dosha, without Mardava of dosha, without Kleyadana of dosha, Samshodhana is impossible. And these three cardinal symptoms are only achieved by Snehapana alone. And Abhyanga we do before Vamana or Virechana, that is also Snehana. So without that, it is impossible to do Shodhana. Whereas other symptoms of Samyak Snigdha Lakshanas like Agni, Dipti, Klama can be achieved, even with the help of Dipanapachana or even with Swedana. So this clearly shows the importance of Snehapana before Shodhana. So Snehapana is important, and application of Snehana is very, very important before Shodhana. Otherwise, Shodhana is impossible. Okay. So basically, I already spoke about it. What Sneha does to the doshas?
Hello.
Basically. Hello. Okay. So Sneha basically Sneha kinna koshtaga dadugava srotolina echa chaka asti samstha doshaha. So basically when you do the, you know, snehapana or internal in administration of snehapana or even with abhyanga andal, so the doshas which are present in dhatu and srotas, basically they are softened. Okay, the softening of doshas are very, very important, you know, because without this softening the svedana cannot act. Those, because softening is very important. By softening, when you apply the svedana, it liquefies the doshas and it brings to the koshta, and from where it can be thrown out of vamana virechana. Okay, so when you do shodhana snehana, whether internally or externally, this is the sneha palam pradita agnihi parishuddha koshta pratyeka. So it is very beautiful and it's very, very important as a puro karma and snehana as a pradana karma also. So the in various diseases you would have seen at the end of you know, every chapter they would have mentioned different ghees. Why? Because you know, initially when you do lots of shodhana karma, it depends on the disease, you do various shodhana karmas. So body goes into ruksha mode and vata always tend to increase. That's why we do, even after vamana virechana also, you know, we do payadi samsarjana and everything. So that is the main reason why, you know, every chapter, if you see the end, they would have, you know, set different gritas. Why? Because you know, this rukshatva sets in after shodhana because of this extreme process. So gritas are mentioned. So not only for this sneha dravyas, not only used for shodhana purpose, but as well as brahmana, as well as shamana purpose also. So every chapter, if you see, it will be there. Okay. So basically, what is you know, this sneha dravya? So basically, we use gritam, vasa, taila, majja, like that. Okay, so in olden days we used to use lots of you know, these native things like taitila tailam, then you have you know, coconut oil, then gritam. These are things, basically this groundnut oil, this are muflika tail, no, it came later, you know. That's the reason why you don't find much reference in Brahatrayas. Why? Because it is native of Arabia. It is not, you know, it has come from Turkey and all those places. That's why it is not mentioned in our Brahatrayas. So in our Brahatrayas, you see mainly these things, Tilatailam, Gritam, you know, then Narikalatailam, all those things. Okay. But later what happened, you know, the ghee is said to be like, you know, they started to projecting the ghee or other snehas as a villain. Okay. Because of the high content of saturated fat in them. But they, in the recent studies and you know, the recent research, they found out that though ghee is a saturated fat, but it is completely different that of other saturated fats. Why? Because the ghee has unique carbon atom structure, which is much smaller than one which is found in commonly fed saturated fat. So this unique carbon atom, which is smaller, that's what makes the ghee special. And you know, though it comes under saturated fat, but definitely because of this setup, it is not going to increase your cholesterol or risk of atherosclerosis. So you know, much you know, researchers are needed to prove this, and already people are into this, and it is getting proved that how best the ghee is. Okay, so this unique carbon atom chain, which is responsible for the therapeutic action of the, are more magical properties, okay, of the ghee. So it is the you know, Mr. Divivekar is, you know, is a Mumbai based dietitian. He wrote a book on it and he did a research also. Okay, and one more nice point is, in 2011, so study by scientists from the National Dairy Research Institute Haryana, published the Indian Journal of Medical Research, states that ghee from cow's milk could actually protect us from cancer, as it enhances the availability of enzymes responsible for detoxification of cancer causing substances. So it is getting proved. So you know, we can obviously, you know, our acharyas were always great, and that is the reason why they chose, you know, gritam is always best, because you know the qualities, samskara anuvardhanam, you know, the dhriti smriti, all those things. Why? Because this is very unique when you compare to other saturated fat. So we can assure and we can say, you know, surely that ghee is not going to cause you any trouble and no need to fear. Because this is a common thing, you know, when we treat a patients, they ask, doctor, you are giving us a fact, like what will happen, you know, if I take it, I may get, you know, my cholesterol may go up, or whether, you know, especially, you know, the people, those who are in 40s, 50s, you know, they will always ask you this question. So definitely we can explain this is what happens. So it is safe. Okay. So ghee serves as an antioxidant also, and it is good for very good for immune system. Okay. And it has high concentration of this butyric acid and fatty acid that contain antiviral properties also. That's the reason why this antiviral and antibacterial ghee is a best wound healer. You know, literally, if you don't have anything else, suppose you are cooking or something, you know, you got a burn, simply you put the ghee there, you see, it will, because, you know, it's fantastic. All right, that is because it is antioxidant and it is antiviral and antibacterial. It is crude also. Okay, so next comes the tilathailam. Why they chose tilathailam? You can see how beautiful. Sesame oil is rich in polyunsaturated and monounsaturated fats. So it is not bogus, it is proved. Okay, because it's a plant oil, you always know that, you know, plant oil is always unsaturated in most of the plant oil, you know, are unsaturated in nature. So sesame oil is rich in polyunsaturated and monounsaturated fat. You know, this unsaturated fat is always best for our body, and low in saturated fats. Okay, say Edwin Clark, RD, and head of nutrition and wellness at yumly.com. Okay, because this is polyunsaturated and monounsaturated, definitely that's the reason why you see it is mentioned, it is good for medorogas, vata kapha rogas. Why? Because you can see there they didn't mention gritam, because gritam may be containing little bit saturated fat, whereas tilathailam, which is polyunsaturated and monounsaturated, that's why, you know, in the wherever there is more kleda, you notice, okay, like diabetes mellitus or obesity and all, go with this tilathaila snehapana, you will get very good results. And, you know, definitely, you know, you will see this cholesterol and other things, even the blood sugar, everything comes down. That is because of this property. Okay. So it is always, you know, that monounsaturated and polyunsaturated fats are heart healthy, and always they keep the cholesterol under control. Okay. So this is also proven, and it is, you know, research has been conducted on these topics. Okay. So we can safely assume that snehapana, which is commonly involves intake of large quantities of ghee, could act as an immune booster, antioxidant, anti-cancerous, and also snehapana may increase LDL cholesterol in the blood in some patients, but it will not be the cause for inducing heart disease. Okay. So second, one more thing. We all know that how, you know, processing is very, very important. Samskaram gunantaradhanam uchyate. So we are processing the gritam or thailam with various herbs, even when you do the murchana. So definitely the internal qualities of the gritam or thailam definitely would, you know, would undergo lots of change. That's what I feel. So I feel maybe like when you cook the ghee with different herbs, so because everything is in atomic level, so the carbon atoms would be, you know, changing a lot. So maybe the ghee would give up its, you know, saturated qualities, or it may turn up into unsaturated also. But we need a lots of research to prove this. Okay. So once again, see, I always believe in this. Ayurveda always say about so many things, even very, very small and very important things. Nowadays, how we are getting the ghee, you just tell me. Basically, we are getting the ghee from, you know, we get in the shop, we go there and we just get it and we start giving it to the patient. Or even in the big companies, you know, just they get the ghee, you know, from outside and they start preparing. And whereas nowadays, what kind of, you know, cow we have? All are imported cows. Whereas in olden days, we had our own cows. And you see, depends on the color of the cow, you know, they explain where it is Vatahara, Pitahara, Kafahara, where, you know, like, they mentioned about black, red, you know, like different colors. And you can see milk drawn from the black colored cow is best, has many beneficial property. And because black color cow is the best and primary one being that destroys all the three doshas. So, you know, I believe that, you know, the research must be done based on this, because nowadays, whenever we are giving snehapana, we just get it from outside and give. And there are lots of, you know, changes, and it's all mechanized. So as I said, samskara gunantara adana muchite. So when we do the, you know, processing with these kind of machines and other things, we really do not know what kind of changes in the chemical level as well as atomic level happening in the ghee and how far it is best, we really don't know. So, you know, if you go to now different goshalas, in Ujjain there is one Swamiji. He always gives me a from our desi ghee. Desi guy. So the Grita is, actually I have a sample. I don't know how to show it. So it is very pure, whitish. It is not like yellowish at all. So basically what I'm trying to say is, I think we must do the study, after obtaining the ghee from our desi cows and see how, it is affecting our cholesterol level and other thing. Why? Because we are basically using the, which is prepared by the companies in the centrifugal and in the pasteurization method. So we don't know what kind of changes happening when you do this, because Ayurveda believes that samskara. So there is a kind of different samskaras happening. So I believe depends on the color of the cow, we must prepare the ghee and try to administer to the patient in like vata patient or pitta patient or kapha patient, and see how the we can compare what changes are happening with when you take it from the normal cows from Jersey or like other cows which are imported from other countries, because our climate and our food is different and their food is different. So basically the genetic level also, because these cows are imported, I believe that genetic plays a very important role. So when we are using such kind of ghee from those cows, maybe like we that it could be the reason why we are getting high cholesterol level, all those stuffs. So when we go back to our roots, I think we are good to go, and I think we can prove to the world. Okay, so one more thing, you see, in many places they feed the cow inside. They found out, you can see a study conducted, okay, in US showed that cows gazing pasture, so when they are going out and eating the grass and other thing, the natural method when they eat, they produce 5 times more of a cancer fighting compound, conjugated linoleic acid. Just imagine, you are getting, nowadays you get big milk factories, and the cows, they don't even take it out. They're all stood in, they're all made stood in one place, and they feed different things, chemicals or so many things, and we are getting the grita from that, and we are using. How we can get the best results out of it? So it is already proved that the cows which eat outside or they roam around, which they eat the natural things, always best producing, they are producing the milk and other products which can fight cancer. So it is very, very important what kind of gritam we are using for Snehapana. I believe when we go back to our roots, when we start using our Deshi Gaika Grita, definitely I do see lots of changes and lots of good results could come. I started doing it. I want to say this from the help of Swamiji. I started a project. I'm doing research based on that. Once once I do it in 100 patient, let me publish thing. Okay, so ghee is very, very important for the keeping the digestive fire active. Otherwise the digestive fire will die. Okay, then one more thing before going further, we must know about the difference between butter oil and ghee. Okay, both are different. So in most of the places, what we are getting is not the ghee, we are getting only butter oil. So butter oil is already, it is stated in Sushruta also, you can get the ghee by milk cream as well as from the curd. Trust me, when you make the curd and prepare a ghee, prepare a navanita out of it, and from that navanita, when you get the ghee, you can call only that one as gritam, because that process is very, very necessary. Whereas when you get the gritam from the milk cream, you cannot call it a ghee, you rather call it as a butter oil. Why? Because both are different, trust me. So when you are using butter oil for Snehapana, I don't think so, you will get proper results, or the cholesterol may go high, or it can create trouble in later, because butter oil is completely different and it is not 100% fat. Still, moisture is there. Whereas pure ghee is 100% fat. Okay. So nowadays in most, where you get this yellowish, whichever ghee is so yellow, trust me, that is from butter oil. that is, you can call it as butter oil, that is from the cream. The ghee, which is little bit whitish only, you know, that is, you know, you get it, that is prepared out of Navanita, or that is prepared out of sour curd. Okay, so this is very, very important. So most of the time we may end up in using butter oil rather than Ghritam, because we have to use Ghritam only, because the good qualities of Ghritam only mentioned in Ayurveda, not the butter oil. Okay, so both are anhydrous form of milk fat, but the fat quantity varies in butter oil as well as the ghee. And the preparation, once again, you see samskaram gunantaradhanam, always keep this in your mind. So butter oil is now, it doesn't undergo so many samskaras, whereas, you know, the curd and navanita process, it undergoes lots of samskaras, because bacteria, yeast, everything plays a role in them. So basically we must not use butter oil, but for, you know, you can use, because it is stated in Ayurveda also, you know, Sushruta says about, you know, ghee prepared out of milk cream. But my preference would be the butter, you know, obtained from the curd, and later from that ghee is made, that is the best, okay? Because, you know, you can go through you can research in various books or even internet, you'll find detail, you know, about butter oil and ghee. So better to use ghee, not the butter oil, okay? Okay, so just I'll skip. Once again, next comes to the vasa and majja, the other one. Okay, so vasa and majja is pure fat, animal fat they are, and obtained from muscle as well as the bone. Okay, and it is believed that it's true also, high consumption of saturated fatty acid is associated with elevated level of serum cholesterol and low density lipoprotein. Okay, so this is because of this fear, always animal products were, you know, always it comes under radar, always it's been criticized, you know, because when you take animal, you know, thing, whether it's a ghee or anything, you are into trouble, you know, because for the past 50 years, that's what they made a research and they concluded it. But I don't agree with that, because now it is slowly coming up. Once again, Ayurveda will win. Okay, so once again, when you see the vasa or majja, it's a pure muscle fat. Okay, so when you're taking the vasa, once again, you know, it's you must understand, because vasa is nothing but a fat, you know, it can be taken out of viscera also. But here Acharya says shuddha mamsa sneham is vasa. So you must obtain the vasa only from the muscle covering. You know, sometimes people take it in the omentum fat also. Trust me, that is not a real vasa, because you can see in my slides what is the difference between the visceral fat as well as what is the difference, the fat covering of the muscle. Both are different. So always, whenever you are trying to give vasa pana, definitely you must get the vasa from the muscle covering, not from the omentum or any other visceral fat. Okay, why? Because they metabolically, there is a difference existing between them. Okay, and deposition of fatty acid also, you know, in the visceral fat, you know, the fatty acid deposition is completely different, whereas the fat which is there in the muscle, the fatty acid and the carbon atom, the you know, the arrangement of carbon atoms are different if the vasa is, or if the fat is on the muscle. So always get, you know, the vasa from the muscle, not from the omentum or any other place, because omental or visceral fat is different, and the vasa is, you know, vasa which is there in the you know, muscle is completely different. Okay, so you can see intramuscular adipocytes have higher activity of the enzymes exokinase and phosphofructokinase. The subcutaneous adipose tissue exhibits higher level of lipogenic enzymes such as NADP, malate, dehydrogenase, okay, and glucose 6 phosphate, etc. Whereas if, you know, these things are more, you know, responsible for, you know, the saturated fat, you know, it's a kind of saturated fat, you can say. They are high risk, okay? So if you see this NADP and this, you know, lipogenic enzymes, all those things will highly increase the saturated fat. So when you take the visceral fat, you may end up in increasing, you know, cholesterol level, you know, and, you know, it may create atherosclerosis. Okay, so in the long run, you know, it's not good. So visceral fat is always not good. So take the wasa from the muscle, because it is the saturated fatty levels are less in muscle. That's why, you know, Shuddha Mamsa Sneha is vasa. Acharya has clearly told where to get the vasa, how great they were, you see. So once again, basically, if you see how to, before that, the fat composition, the composition of fatty acids of animal origin can be influenced by diet, by the digestive system, and by the biosynthetic process of animal. So it is once again, what kind of vasa we are using, very, very, very important. That's the reason in Ashtanga Sangraham, 6th chapter, Sutrasthana, Acharya Vagbhata mentioned, Varaha Vasa is the best. You know why Varaha Vasa is best? Because it is a, you know, this pig, you know, is like a human. You know, it is like, it comes under ruminant. So ruminant means like they have only one digestive system. Whereas if you see, you know, other animals like cow, buffalo and all, they have four chambers for digestion. Whereas we have only one stomach, like pig also, like human, only one stomach it has. That's why, you know, it is said that Varaha Vasa is best, not, you know, other vasas, because those animals like cow or buffalo, they are different, or you know, because they have four chambers digestive pathway, whereas we have one. That is the reason why, whereas pig is also same, this Varaha Vasa is mentioned. So the fat deposition in visceral and muscle is different. So always try to get, okay, from the muscle fat. Okay, so we must use this Varaha Vasa. So basically, you can see Varaha Vasa, sorry, I mentioned is a ruminant. Varaha, it's a non-rumitant. So we humans are pig, etc. Even horse are non-rumitant, because we are all equal, you know, the digestive. So the digestion and metabolism also, it involves, depends on the diet and everything. So once again, Vasa also we must prepare. So basically, what happens, how to get this vasa? So basically, you know, when you go to the, you know, butcher shop, you ask him, so they can give the, you know, fat coverings. So it is called marbling. So you will see the red meat, and you cut it above that, you will see that yellowish white fat, that is vasa. Ask him to scrape it and give. Okay, then just, you know, you can put it in a pan, start heating it. It will become like oil. Then you can, store it. That's, you can store it. That's it. Otherwise, what you can do, the vasa content or even the muscle with vasa, you can just put it in a hot water, start boiling it. The oil content will start floating it, and you can take out, and you can safely use it. So basically, what I found in my clinical practice, this vasa pana is really, really highly beneficial in the diseases of neuromuscular diseases, and especially the diseases like Parkinson's or diseases like Alzheimer's, where, you know, the problem with the brain development, no, this vasapana is really, really helping. So basically, you know, it's very, you know, the smell is very awkward, and it is very, very, the taste is very awkward. So what happens in my village and all, they are, I have seen, even like my grandfather used to treat the cows. So if the cow or bull, you know, has fallen down, it is not because of strength, no strength, or because of some issues or some disease, they may not be getting up. So, you know, they will lose completely strength. That time what he will do is, he takes this Varaha Vasa, keep it inside the banana. That too, we have one special banana, that big one, you know, in our South India, we get that. That's a big one. We use it for making these curries or sabji. So he keeps, that should be ripened banana, and he keeps this Vasa inside, and he start feeding that cow for 7 to 10 days. So after that, I've literally seen, like, slowly that cows gets up. So this prompted me to use this vasa in the people, those who have this difficulty in walking, especially the gait problems. No, trust me, you know, I have some videos also. It is really, really, you know, I have seen one person, you know, literally started walking. So it is very, very good. But in clinically we use very less, but I believe that, you know, this vasa pana could be highly beneficial in those cases where, you know, the mobility is getting affected. So once again, next is, majja, you know, it is asti sneha is majja. So basically, you get any lamb, or how to extract it, very simple. Any lamb or any, cow, you know, big bones, you take it, you chop it, and start, put water and start boiling it. So once you boil it, the majja will start floating, then you can just, you know, filter it and store it. That's it. Okay. Once again, if you see, we will see next topic is Milita Sneha Namani, that is Yamakam, Trivirth, and Mahasneham. You know, like one basically mixing of two Sneha is Yamakam, mixing of three is Trivirth, and mixing of four together is Mahasneham. So in this, once again, Acharyas have different opinions whether only mixed Girtam and Thailam is called Yamakam, or mixing any two are called as Yamakam, or mixing any three is called as Yamakam, or mixing only Girtam, Thailam and Vasa is Yamakam. So this, I know there is two opinions are there. So basically, you know, we can choose whatever, there is no clear cut. But basically mixing Sneha, Thailam and Girtam, we practice, you know, in day-to-day practice, we always mix Girtam and Thailam, and we should use Yamaka Sneham. Okay. So basically, this Trivirth Yamakam, if you see these things, nowadays, like, you know, you might have heard about this Kolambus in Kerala. You have Balashwagandha Adi Kolambu, or this Sahachara Adi Kolambu, all those things. So they are nothing but Yamaka or Trivirth Sneha. Then once again, in some of the Gritam also, take the example in Sukumaram Gritam, you use Aranda Thailam as well as Gritam, and you have Panchasneham, Chatusneham, all those things are there. So there are, what is the, you know, why they mentioned about this Yamakam, Trivirth, Mahasneham, no? The why they made this Kolambus, no? Kolambus are very highly viscous in nature. When you compare to Thailam, the Kolambus are highly viscous in nature. They are very, very, you know, little bit thick, you know, so the fat content is more. When there is a more fat content, the absorption will be more. That's why, you know, Kolambus are more, you know, like, that's why it is used in Shuddha Vata Rogas. Why? Because where too much Rokshatva is there, where you need more Snehana. So that is the reason why you use Kolambus there. This Kolambus is nothing but Mahasneham or Yamakasneham or Trivirth. So usually in Kerala, the practice is when they are preparing the Kolambus, no, either they use Aranda Thailam or Tila Thailam with, Aranda Thailam mixed with Tila Thailam, or this neem oil mixed with Tila Thailam. In some Vritta Vaidyas, instead of Aranda Thailam and this neem oil, they use Varagavasa. So they prepare the oil and they end, they add the Varagavasa, then they make the Kolambus. Okay, so Kolambus are nothing but this Yamakar Trivirth Sneha. They are highly viscous in nature. So it is very good for Shuddha Vata Rogas. Okay. So I made some slides about lipids and other thing. Due to time constraint, I'm just, quitting. Okay. Because we have to cover so many things. So you might be knowing about saturated, unsaturated fat, polyunsaturated, what happens. So I already covered in Gritam and Thailam, what fats are happening, what is that. Okay. So I just want to, you know, skip them. Okay, so next, you know, Sneha classification, that also, you know, various classifications mentioned depends on, you know, Prayogam, Samyogam, Matra, Yoni, like that. You know, it all, you know, in a clinical practice, you know, it is really, really, you know, once you start practicing, they are all really helpful. Okay, so this is very, very important. When to give what Snehana and seasonal indication and whether to give pure ghee or medicated ghee, it is always a big debate. So we'll go through one by one. Okay. Once again, this simple sarpihi sharadi padavyam. Okay. Vasamajatu madhave thailam pravarshi naakti shetane snehanam pibenaram. So all these rules and regulations they mentioned, no, it is mostly for swastha person. Okay. And shamana sneha purpose. For shodhananga purpose, we can give any time, any day. Okay. And, when a person is suffering from the disease, you know, it can be given, anytime according to this Agni and, Koshta. So this, particular, aspect of Snehapana is only for Swastha person. And as well as, you can consider this when you are trying to give Shamana Sneha also. And once again, as a part of Rudhacharya and Dinacharya, you want to do Shodhana. So that time, that's why Sarpihi Sharadi Padavyam, they said, okay, because, it can be used as a immune booster. So they told these rules and regulations. Okay. And lastly, Kashyapa says at the end, Sarpi is best for all season. Okay. And once again, Shita Kale Diva, Ishneha Mushna Kale, Piben Nishi. So here, Nishi means we always think night. No, it's not night. The first prahara of the evening. So, like, first 3 hours of the evening, that's what Dalhana says. So basically, when the climate is very cold, okay, it should be given in the daytime when the sun is good, bright. So when if it is Ushnakala, it should be given in the Nishi. Once again, this rule is applicable for Shamana Sneha or Brahmana Sneha, because you know if you see Shodhananga Sneha, it should be always given in the morning. It should not be in the evening. Acharya has already explained clearly. So these rules are for, as I said, Shamana Sneha, Brahmana Sneha, and as well as it should be done when you want to do a Shodhana as a part of Ruticharya. Okay. So why he said, you know, you can see, understand, you know, why Grita is best followed by Taila. Lastly, they kept Vasa and Majja. That Chakrapani clearly explains, they both are neither too hot nor cold, and they are not so effective in alleviating three doshas. You can see this point is very, very important. When you compare to Tailam and Gritam, Vasa and Majja are least, you know, like they are not, you know, so good, so effective in alleviating the doshas. That's the reason why, you know, it is told to given in a, you know, Maghava Masa, where there is not too hot nor too cold, you know, that season, okay? So that is the reason why, you know, we always prefer Gritam or Tailam, okay? And here, once again, he says, Samshamanameva Ushna Kalecha Sah.
Okay,
ma'am.
Okay, sir.
Can I continue, ma'am?
Sorry for the inconvenience.
No, it's... yes, ma. Once again, I have to share, ma. Okay. So next we'll see a little bit about Sneha Arhas. Okay. So you know this Swedya. So in this, I will explain why these people are. See, you must understand this, whatever they said about this, you know, eligible or the persons eligible for internal island Sneha Arhas, this is only just to give us some ideas. Okay. So depends on the condition, depends on the, you know, disease, you can always choose. Or, you know, whether to give or not to give. Because how, you know, for this also Acharya has explained in Charaka Siddhi first chapter, okay? This beautifully he explained, okay? Chardi Hridroga Gulminam Vamanam Swa Chikistite Avastam Prapya Nirdishtam Kushtinam Vasti Karmacha Vinatarkena Yasiddhir Yadricha Siddhir Yavacha. So he says, you know, though Vasti is contraindicated in Kushta, if you see, you know, Vasti indication and contraindication, Kushta comes there. But if you see the Kushta Adhikara, Vasti is mentioned. Okay. And once again in Hridroga, okay, and Chardi, Vamana is contraindicated. But still, when you see Chardi Roga and Hridroga, Vamana is indicated there. So, Avastam Prapya Nirdishtam. So, he says, see the Avastha of a patient. See the Avastha of a. Ayurveda is very versatile. the end of the day, they will give everything, they will put everything on our head. You decide. You decide. You are the best judge like that. So avastham prapya nirdishtam. Okay, depends on the avastha, dosha avastha as well as rogi avastha. Definitely, you must go for, you know, some therapies, though which are contraindicated, you know, in those therapies. Okay, so that is the reason why when we see this sneharhas, this is only simple idea to give us that in these persons, definitely you must give. That means to say in these persons, definitely you must give, but that doesn't mean that in other cases, we should not give. Okay, so you know that Svedya Samshodya, that slokam, right? So why this simply, you know, we'll see why these persons, you know, acharyas are told about this, you know, persons. So basically, if you see Vyayama Nitya, Madhya Nitya, Chintakand, Stri Nitya will have excessive Vata vitiation. So Snehapana is the best way to tackle this vitiated Vata. Okay. So basically, too much Rukshata will be there and too much Vata vitiation is there. That's why Snehapana must be given in this patient. Then in Vriddha Avastha, so Dhatu Kshayam, Dhatu Shithilata is happening due to excessive Vata. So Snehapana, if you give, it nourishes the body, so snana should be given to these patients. Then once again, in Abala, Krisha, Ruksha, okay? Excuse me. Krisha and Ruksha person, okay, all these conditions are due to excessive Vata vitiation. In order to nullify the vitiated Vata, once again, Snehapana is given. Of course, before Shodhana, Snehapana must be given. Otherwise, the Dhatus goes for Shithilata and the body is destroyed. Okay? Okay? Next, Asnehanam Varanam. So, persons contraindicated. Once again, you see Urustimba, all those things are there. We'll see why they are. So, in Ruksha Ahara person, if the person is always taking Ruksha Ahara, so what happens? Kapha Medha will be more and Abhishenda is extreme. So in these people, okay, the Kapha and Medha will be more, okay, and you know, that means Ruksha Ahara means where you need to do, sorry, not Ahara, Ruksha Arha. So where you need to do Rukshana therapy. So there you cannot do Snehana therapy. Why? Because the person who is eligible for Rukshana therapy, there will be Kapha and Medha will be more. And Abhishenda will be extreme. Okay. So Snehapana, if you give, will worsen the above said conditions and she should not be administered. Then in Srotorodham, Snehapana increases the Srotorodha because it's once again blocked and it is Guru and you know Snehapana, you know the qualities. And Srotorodha is common in Tarnujwara and Udara Roga and Urustamba. That's why in Tarnujwara, Udara Roga and Urustamba, Snehapana is not advocated because Srotorodha is seen in these conditions and Snehapana increases Srotorodha. So when you give Snehapana in these conditions, it will once again increase the disease. Okay. Then Ama and Agni Mandyam, of course, weak Agni cannot withstand Snehapana dose and cannot digest the Snehadravya. Okay. So in Ama, once again, there will be Srotorodham and if Snehapana administered, once again, it leads to complications. That's why it is contraindicated. Once again, it is contraindicated Chardi, Aruchi, Ajirnam, Annadveshi, Vishapidita. Because you see, Chardi, already the person is vomiting, you know, it is impossible practically. You cannot ask the person to go and have it. Or if the person is having nausea also, already, you know, he is having too much nausea. When you go, even the smell of his Snehadreva, he can't stand. It will increase further Chardi. Aruchi, once again, it is due to Ama and Agni Mandya. Loss of taste, so you cannot give that. In Ajirna, of course, Ajirna, no treatment should be given except Satyavamana, okay? And Annadveshi, already Annadvesham is once again stomach irritation and other things, you know, he cannot even withstand the food, then how can he withstand the Snehadravya? And Vishapidita, of course, you know, when the person is Vishapidita, immediately you must go for Satyavamana there, okay? Because you need to take out the Visha. But if you, Snehapana there, if you give, the Visha will mix with Snehadravya and it will start spreading all over the body. So it should not be given. Okay. Then after Datta Vasti, Vamana and Virechana, the body will be tired and weak. Okay. After Virechana, Vamana, the patient needs rest and the Agni is also weak there. So how you can give Snehapana? So, and if you give Snehapana, this one will lead to complication and the person may go further, you know, he will weaken further. That's why it should not be given. And in Durbala, Bala and Vriddha. So this is, once again, you must see these indications are contraindications for Shodhanangasneha. So in Durbala cannot withstand the dose of Shodhananga Sneha. Even Bala and Vridha, so there you need to go this Vicharna Sneha board. So this Shodhananga Sneha Pana cannot be given to them because they can't withstand the strength of Sneha Dravya. Okay, once again in Atyagni, if you give, you know, it doesn't solve the purpose because it will not do dosha utklesham there. So the Snehana will be digested, okay, and it will act as a fuel also, so the Atyagni will increase. Okay, and in Atisthula and Agni Medho Vridhi, once again, Snehapana administered, it will make the Stavulya worse. That's why in these conditions, what Acharya says, Rukshapurva Snehapanam. So you do Ruksha treatment first, followed by Snehapana, then it will be all right. Otherwise, directly you cannot give Snehapana. In Adhisara Pedita and Madhya Pedita, okay, so you cannot, the person's body and mind is already weak. So in Madhya Pedita, you know, it's like a poison once again. And you know, he cannot cooperate, he will not cooperate also, you cannot go and give it to him. And when you give, once again, you know, when you take the Madhya, liver load will be already high. So if you give more fat, it will increase further liver load, or it may even cause, you know, liver damage. So it should not be. And Adhisara Pedita, of course, you know, already person will be, he would have lost so much of, you know, water and electrolyte balance. Once again, you cannot administer Snehapana because during Snehapana, the food and other things are very less. So, you know, once again, it can, in the person will be weakened further. So it should not be given. Okay. Of course, Urustamba is contraindicated. In Apaprasuda, the doshas are vitiated state. Hence cannot be given. Dalghana says in Navaprasuta, there is excessive Rakta and Kleda and Mala. Snehana provokes them if it is administered. Of course, she will be very weak. Okay. So immediately delivered woman, you cannot give any Shodhana there because she will not withstand. Okay. Then Chidrodhara Dagodhara, Agni is weak, hence contraindicated. Not only that, in Chidrodhara Dagodhara, you know the pathological condition of liver it is. Already liver will be, you know, under enormous, you know, trouble. So in that you cannot, and a person will have other complications like vomiting, you know, when there is a liver cirrhosis, you know, that's why this Chidra Dagodhara and all happens. So already the person will be weak and there will be lots of vomiting and all. So you cannot give Snehapana there. Okay, in Ajirna, once again, Ama and Alpagni, so it cannot be digested, okay? So, next, we'll see Snehapana Matra. So, in Brihatris, basically the Snehapana Matra is given, depends on the Koshta and Agni alone. Okay, it's very, very important, okay? And only Sushruta explained, depends on the like Koshta and Agni, and you know, depends on how many hours it takes for digestion. So depends on the digestive time and depends on the Koshta and Agni. Whereas only in Laghutrayi Kalam, you see this Hriswa, Madhyama and Uttama Matra, they mentioned in the, you know, exact dose form, okay, the quantity form. Whereas Brihatrayi times, there is no quantity form is mentioned. Only during Laghutrayi times, the quantity form is mentioned. But trust me, you know, this is still, you know, when you use this quantity form, you won't get proper samyak. Maybe for Shamana Sneha and all you can use, and Brahmana Sneha, you can use this method. But, you know, you cannot use this one, you know, for Shodhananga Snehapana because it doesn't give you any good result at all. I'm not against Acharyas, but this is my personal opinion. So, like, you know, Sharangadhara and Bhava Mishra, like they, he said, like, Hriswa is 2 tola, Madhyama is 3 tola, and Hrisiyasi, Uttama is 4 tola. Then Chakradatta Hrisiyasi explained only by this Sushruta and Vagbhata. Okay. And according to Chakradattam, it is 2 karsha, 3 karsha, and 1 pala. Okay. This is the quantitative matra of Sneha Dravya. Whereas Brihatris never mentioned these quantitative matras. They mentioned according to the time of digestion, how much time it takes, the Sneha Dravya takes to digest. Okay. So that is the main this one. So basically, now we'll see about Hrisiyasi Matra, which is very, very important. The test dose. Okay. So what is Hrisiyasi? Iyam Hriswa. Iyam Anene Anayor Iti Atishayena Hriswa Iti Hrisiyasi. Okay. So basically, it's a small test dose. Okay. This, according to Dalhana, Hrisiyasi means Yama Parinama Miti Matra Prakalpet. So which is digested in one yama, that is, you know, that Sneha Dravya, if you are administering the quantity which is digested in 1 hour, is called as Hrisiyasi Matra according to Dalhana. So why you should do this Hrisiyasi Matra? Because अज्ञात कोष्ठेहि बहुकुर्यात् प्राण संशयम्. सो इफ यू डोंट नो द अग्नि एंड कोष्ठ, इफ यू डोंट नो द स्ट्रेंथ ऑफ अग्नि और डाइजेस्टिव पावर ऑफ द पेशेंट, देन इफ यू आर एडमिनिस्ट्रिंग स्नेहपान यू मे एंड अप इन गिविंग मोर डोज. ओके, बिकॉज इफ यू डोंट नो द प्रॉपर अग्नि एंड कोष्ठ यू मे एंड अप इन गिविंग मोर डोज. सो दट कैन किल द पर्सन. अज्ञात कोष्ठेहि बहुकुर्यात् प्राण संशयम्. सो इन ऑर्डर टू know the koshta and agni of the person, rishyasi matra must be administered, because without, you know, that if you administer snehapana, either you create complication or you may not get proper result or it may even kill the patient. Okay, so next we will see about accha sneham. Accha means accha payascha accha paya, pure unmixed, because you know snehapana can be with food, we can give with food or without food, only in a broad classification. So why they mention this accha sneha means here you eat the pure fat should be given, there should not be mixing of anything. Okay, so here once again people ask whether mixing means whether it is whether we should give pure ghee or medicated ghee, because acharya say accha pana it's a pure ghee. You can say chakrapani clearly explains that vodanaadi asambandhi sati paya, so it should not be mixed vodana etc. He never uses, you know, because you know food is different, medicine is different. Okay, because food is rasa pradana, medicine is virya pradana, right? So vodanaadi asambandhi payah, so achapana should not be mixed with any food and edibles. That's what he says. He never mentions about, you know, this medicine, all those things. So here we can consider, and I'll tell you later also. So better to use the you know medicated ghritas, which gives always good results. So pure fat drinking without, you know, mixing with any other thing, because why it is best, achameva pibet sneham achapanam achapka achapanam hi bhujitam, why it should be taken, because sneha karma aashushadana. So if you take vicharana or sadya sneha and all, it will not give, you know, and sneha prabhutatvat. Okay, it is the best because sneha karma aashush, so it will give beautiful and instant result, and it is very, very, you know, best for treating the diseases. Why? Because it is so powerful. When you compare vicharana and sadhya sneha and all, they are not powerful, whereas accha snehana is very powerful, and sneha karma ashushadana is only achieved by accha sneha. Excuse me. Hence, you know, for shodhana purpose achapana only should be given. Okay, so according to basically achapana is shodhanacham or shamanacham, because brahmana sneha we cannot include with this, because brahmana is mixed with food and all. So if you see shodhanacham and shamanacham, okay, shodhana sneha we give bahumatra, whereas shamanacham it is madhyama matra. So it is shodhana sneha is given for 3 to 7 days, whereas shamana sneha till the vyadhi shamana happens. Okay, then time of administration achapana shodhanacham we give in the fixed time, early morning. Okay, whereas shamana accha sneham we give, you know, when there is a good appetite. Then anupana depends on the sneha. Okay, once again, for shamana accha depends on roga. Okay, then shamik snigdha lakshanas, it is very visible, whereas in shamana accha only certain shamik snigdha lakshanas are visible. Okay, and post therapy shodhana accha, once you give shodhananga snehapana accha snehapana, you must give either vamana or virechana, whereas shamana accha you don't need any shodhana. Okay, so once again, this is, once you give the achapana, it is always said that it should be followed by some kind of anupana, as well as what kind of acha, you know, the previous slide I told you, whether always there is a debate is still there whether to give pure ghee or medicated ghee. Okay, for shodhana purpose, whether simple ghritam is indicated or medicated ghee is indicated. Okay, so this is always, is there some you know great scholars, they say more simple ghee is enough. Some scholar says you know this medicated ghee is enough, because you know for sure you need dosha utkleshas, medicated ghee it may suppress some of the you know symptoms, so the dosha shodhana may not occur. So that is the reason why pure ghee must be given. That's what they are saying. But if you see classic, you know, this is my interpretation, okay? So if you see the classics, there is clear-cut evidence. I personally prefer to use the medicated ghee. Why? Because medicated taila, that's what it is mentioned. You know, otherwise, why should they mention, you know, all those sneha dravyas like ghatam, taila, everything after that test? So, you know, once again, if it is processed with medicine, always medicine will help to achieve, you know, good results. And I have concluded the study also when you use simple, in some diseases, take the example Kushta and all, when you give Tiktakamara Maha, Tiktaka Snehapana, that gives a different result. When you give simple ghee, that gives, you know, very less results. So obviously, you know, if you give medicated ghee, it is result oriented. Okay, you can see, Kevalam Paitihe Sarpir, okay? And so if you see this Achapana, this Kapha, it should be given Lavana and Trikatu. In a Vata, it should be given with the in Kapha, Tirikatu and Pippali, and Vata with Lavana, and for Pitta, Kevalam, they said. But once again, if you see, Kevalam, Asahayam. So whether this is, you know, about Dalhana's explanation. So he says in Kevala Pitta condition, pure ghee must be given, and in Kapha condition, Chara and Tirikatu must be mixed and given. And in Vata condition, Lavana should be mixed and given. But here he explains, says, you see, Kevalam Asahayam Anyadrava Samyukta Mityartha Tatcha Samskritam Asamskritam Va. Okay, so it can be processed, neither processed or not. It can be processed, you know, or unprocessed ghee can be used. This is what he says. Okay, but it should not be having any Prakshepa Rahitam. Okay, so prakshepa, so kevalam kvata churnita prakshepa rahita sar. That's what he says. Etena samskritam asamskritam means, once again he says, here Atya has clearly explained samskritam or asamskritam means kevalam kvata churnita prakshepa rahitam. You should not use any prakshepas, whereas you can process with medicines. That's what he clearly says. Whereas if you see Gayadasa, clearly he says, Pittahara Dravya Sadita Meva Kavalam Ityartha. So basically what it means, so if you are preparing to give ghee, then mix it with the Lavana for Vata, Akshara Tirikatu, so that means it is medicated only. Then here Pitta, though they said Kavalam, that still he says, Pittahara Dravya Sadita Meva. So it is very clear cut explanation that it is better to use always, you know, the processed Gritam. You can see once again, Vangasana is very safe. You know, he says, Sneham Pakkam Apakkam Va Payitva Chikitsakaha. So for Achapana purpose, it can be used, you know, whether you can use cooked or uncooked Sneha can be given. Okay? You can see, but Chakrapani says, Asamskritam Tu Sarvada Viruddham Eva. Once again, Chakrapani clearly says, Asamskritam Tu Sarvada Viruddham Eva. So Samskrita Gritam or Samskrita Sneha is very, very important, and according to me, it is clear-cut explanations are available all over the text. So I prefer, you know, and according to the text also, Samskrita Gritam or Samskrita Sneha only. Okay? So once again, coming to the dose. So Achapana Kala. So Mridu Koshtam Tri Ratrena Sniheti Achya Upasevya Sniheti Kura Koshtastu Sapta Ratrena Manava. So minimum duration of fat, Shodhananga Snehapana fat drinking is 3 days, and maximum is 7 days. Okay, so what about Madhyama? Once again, Acharya clearly says, especially Arnodatta, okay, and even Dalhana says, Madhyama Shadaham. Okay, so in 6 days, Madhyama Koshta person will get some Samyaksnidhilakshanas. Okay, and according to Arnodatta, 5th or 6th day, the Samyaksnidhilakshanas you can see in Madhyama Koshta person. Okay, this is my thing based on Taratama of Koshta. You can see if the person is okay, have Mridu Koshta. So in Mridu, so you can always use certain yardsticks to, you know, see the to test the Koshta or bowel. You can see, like, you know, like Kruro Koshta, Mridu Koshta, Madhyama Koshta is there. So you can see, like, you can use scoring pattern. So that will be easy in practically. Okay, suppose you have a Mridu Koshta person, you can say how many per day. Okay, he goes 2 times stools. Okay, you don't need to wait. Once he gets up in the morning, so you know he goes 2 times to the stools, you can give scoring 1. You don't need to wait in the morning, immediately go to the toilet, you know, that scoring is 2. Third one, he don't need to push, automatically it comes, scoring is 3. So for Madhyama Koshta person, he takes like when he get up, it takes like half an hour to go. That is scoring one, and he need little push scoring two. Okay, and he goes only one, and it is banana stools, like big farm stools. So like that, if you can give scoring pattern, no, then easily you can assess the posture. Then easily you can practically give the dose according to his posture. Definitely in 7 days you will get some snigdha lakshanas in crore posture person. So once again depends on this taratama veda. I made this slide. Okay, mridu person 3 days, mridu tara in 4 days, mridu tama person 5 days. So this is practically you can use this. Okay, it's very easy to fix the dose. Okay, and according to Angasena, highest dose should be taken for only 1 day, medium dose should be taken for 3 days, and lowest dose for 1 week. Okay, so we can say this particular this one. Okay, so the last day, okay, 7th day we give highest dose. That's why we, you know, the highest dose should be given only 1 day. Of course, usually in the 6th day or 5th day or 7th, last day or another dose will be highest. So once again, for Akshasneha, they mentioned different anupanas. Jalam ushnam grite payam yushes taile anushasyate. Okay, so majjastu mandaha. So for gritam, yusham for tailam, and mandam for this the vasan majja. Why? Because you see, ushna jala is very simple. Ghee can melt by ushna jala. Yusha, why it is given in tailam is good for vata, and we give in vata condition where more kleda condition and more vata condition. So you see, yusha is very good for anupana, as yusha contains more protein, alkaline in nature, and counteracts the vidahi nature of taila. Whereas vasa and majja are gurutva, they are very heavy. So lagu anupana must be given. So manda is very watery portion of the rice. So you need starch and you need something very light. That's why manda is administered when you give vasa and majja. Okay. Next one is we'll see shamana sneha. So shamana sneha is nothing but palliative oilation. So rogasya shamanartham ubhayanjamana sneha. So here, see how we achieve the shamana or shodhana depends on the dose, depends on when you are administering. By these two criteria only, the gritam or tailam will act as shamana or shodhana. So there is no question of samskritam or asamskritam ghee or processed or non-processed ghee. Even if you give the processed ghee, okay, that is any medicated ghee or medicated tailam, if you give according to the koshta and agni and according to the shodhana time, it will act as shodhana only. So the dose and the time of administration is very important for achieving the shamana of dosha or shodhana of dosha. So that's it. Okay, so rogasya shamanartham ubhayanjamana sneha. Okay, so basically it is used for shamana purpose, shamana of the doshas. So basically what we happens directly, we don't use shamana sneha in day-to-day practice. If a person comes, we always see his agni, kosha, everything. If in pure vata condition only, where you see there is no avarnam, that's why kevalam nirupastambam snehamadav prayojayet. In nirupastamba vata only sneha should be given, otherwise sneha should be nirupastamba means avarna rahitam chakrapani. So in avarna rahita vata condition directly you can give shamana sneha, whereas if avarna is there or any, though it is a vata condition, directly you cannot give the shamana sneha. First you need to prepare the body, agni, and you need to remove the kleda and everything. Once you feel that pure vata symptoms are there, the person is ready for shamana sneha, then you should start giving shamana sneha. Then because it is rohasya shamanartham ubhayanjamana sneha, take the example in kushtam or psoriasis, you give sneha shodhananga sneha pana. Okay, then virechana shodhana, then vyadhi krama and all. Okay, then after some time you start giving him shamana sneha, like tektakam, mahatektakam, or depends on the which kind of psoriasis it is. So give them because trust me, many times when you give follow up like kashayams after shodhana, better to give gritam, shamana sneham better to give, so that it won't relapse. I have seen it when you give gudikas or other things, it does help, but not so much. Along with them, you start giving this gritam, definitely it keeps the, especially in psoriasis and all, it keeps the disease under control. So once again, these are the indications. So shamana sneha must be given in these indications. Why they give, once again I'm stressing this point, why they give these indications? In these indicated diseases, definitely you must give. Whereas other diseases, you can decide whether to give, not to give. Okay? So once again, dosha anukarshini matra sarva marga anusarini balya punarnavakari sharira indre chesam. So it is, so sarva marga anusari, koshta sandhi marma shaka anusarini. So it can go, when you administer shamana sneha, it can penetrate, you know, each and every cell, you know, koshta sandhi asti marma, everywhere it can go and take care of the disease. Okay, and punarnavakari, you can see, nishesha dosha haratvena. So it completely pacifies the doshas. That's what it is called as punarnavakari. Okay, so what dose should be given? Uttama matra samshamana eva param. So uttama matra should be given. Here it is a little bit vakbata and charaka differs here. For shodhananga, you know, charaka says madhyama matra, whereas vakbata says uttama matra. For shamana, you know, charaka says uttama matra, vakbata says madhyama matra. So really, I don't know why it is this, you know, I really don't know. Okay. So, natu shodhananga sneha kartavya iti chakrapani. So, uttama matra should be given and uttama matra should be given only for shamana sneha. Okay. So, what is the dose? You can see clearly it is stated in our text. How much shamana sneha should be given? Okay. Uttamasya phalam matra. Deya deeptagnir matra snehasya pala sammita. So, one pala is the dose. So, but nowadays one pala is around 50 ml. In some patients, of course, you can give 50 ml every day, but it is very, very difficult. Okay. So 25 to 30 ml is the maximum dose you can give, not more than that. Okay. So when to give this? Okay. So shamana, I told you, dose and, dose and the time. So some shamana sneham anna kale prakanshitaha. So it should be given when the person is having good appetite. Okay, this is very important. Without appetite, you should not give shamana sneha. Then if you give shamana sneha without appetite, or without, if the person don't have good appetite or hunger, if you give shamana sneha, it will not act. Shamanaha shudvato ananno madhyama matrasta shasyate. So shudvato ananno, without food, the person who is having hungry without food, so he should have excellent hunger, you know, wait for time. You say, when you feels, no, I can't tolerate my hunger, ask him to take. Okay. Once he taken the shamana sneha, he should not eat food. What he should do? Diet. Daya yusho rasova. Okay. Asthanat krita krito. Yusho rasova syat krita akrutova. Alpa sarpishkova vilepirva vidiyate. Okay. So yavat esha jiryati tavat na bojyam ityartaha. So until the shamana sneha is digested, the person should not eat anything. Once he develops the proper appetite, he must be given yusham or mamsarasam or vilepi with alpa sarpi. Okay, next we'll, so that is about shamana sneha. So nowadays, you know, we usually 25 to 30 ml we give, depends on the disease, but in chronic diseases, please, you know, give shamana sneha, especially neurological diseases like Parkinson's, you know, because that is the reason. Even psychological diseases, you would have seen, you know, when you see the psychological diseases, always gritam comes first, like apasmara, munmada, matattva abhinivesham. You see gritapana is mentioned enormously there. We will see later, you know, how it is really true, because, you know, when you take the ketogenic diet or when the ketosis happens due to high fat intake, you know, that brain is stimulated. They found out it cures epilepsy, and you know, it takes care of even everyday taking 2 teaspoons of simple pure ghee or coconut oil is controlling the Alzheimer's. See, our acharyas were very great. That is the reason you see, when you see the psychological cases, psychological explanation, the gritam is always mentioned there. Okay, so in these cases, you know, you do the, you know, proper study, and you know, when the Agni is good, please ask them to continue the Gritam, the best. That's why Acharya has clearly mentioned there. Okay, so now we'll see Shodhananga Sneha Panam. So, and once again, these are the indications where, you know, this is Bahudosha Avastha. Basically, where you give Shodhananga Sneha Panam, it should be given in Bahudosha Avastha. Okay, where, you know, the doshas are need to be expelled out of the body, so it should be given, and you know, basically. In upasthita dosha avastha. Okay, so upasthita dosha means the doshas chakam tektva koshtagamane pradhanatamam prapya avastham pradhanatamam prapya doshanam iti. So this snehapana does this upasthita dosha avastha. Okay, so this upasthita dosha avastha is completely done by this shodhananga snehapana. Okay, that is as I already explained. Okay, this shakam tektva koshta agamanena pradhanatvam prapya doshana abhidhi. So this particular aspect is only done by shodhananga snehapana. So in pradhana avastha condition only, or upasthita dosha avastha or bahudosha condition only, we use shodhana. Okay, so the dose is, once again, as I said, you know, the minimum is 3 days and maximum is 7 days, and you know, minimum is 3 hours and maximum is 24 hours. Okay, and once again, the lahutra is mentioned, the dose in karsha or phala dose, but trust me, it doesn't work properly for shodhananga. Why? Because you don't get proper shodhana effect. So I always prefer to give shodhananga snehapana according to the kosha and agni only. And in a day-to-day practice, it is not so difficult to access, that it is very easy only. Okay, when to give? Okay, so either 3 days or 5 days or 6 days or 7 days. Shodhananga sneha, when to give? Shuddhyartham punar ahare nishe jirne pibe naraha. That means, okay, all right, exactly in the morning. Ahare nishi. Okay, once the, you know, previous day taken food is digested. Always, you know, we should take light food, that we'll see later. Okay, sneha se pitoan abhishwaha pasyan pitoan abhiso. The person who is wish to take snehapana should take light diet, or who is undergoing snehapana should take light diet. Even after snehapana, you should take light diet. Okay, so shuddhyartham punar ahare nishi jirne piben naraha. Once, you know, the previous diet is digested well, then the next day morning, okay, it should be given. So Shushruta, it is clearly explained, it should be given in the early morning when the sun is rising. Okay, yastane jirneva ne sneho achaha shuddhyate bahu. So achapana should be given immediately after the digestion of food, and here the person should not have hungry. If we have hungry, then it will act as a shamanas. So it should be given when he is not having appetite. Histane anne aharne jirna eva jirna matre eva anusanniva. Okay, so this shuddhide shodhanartha achaha kevalam. So achha sneham only should be given. Okay, so the person should not have appetite, and it should be given in the early morning. Okay, so he says, what happens if you take, if the person is having good appetite? Hemadri opines that if it is taken when the person is hungry, due to agnipala is uttama when person is hungry, the entire quantity will be digested. The purpose of shodhananga is to excite the dosha, that is dosha utkleshana. Dosha utkleshana do not occur in uttama agni state. So that is the reason why, you know, it should be given when the person is not having appetite, but his adhara is digested. Okay, so nowadays we practice this shodhananga arohana snehapana. You don't see this directly. I emphasize this word. You don't have any direct evidence of arohana snehapana in brahatrayas, but it does. Okay, so basically the word arohana means rising or ascending. Okay, arohana snehapana, okay, means every day we increase certain quantity of sneha dravya according to the koshta and agni of the person. Okay, we slowly increase the dose so as to get samyak snigdha lakshanas on the third day or fifth day or seventh day. So third day mrudu koshta, fifth day madhyama koshta, and seventh day uttama koshta. Okay, so I want to quote this shastram jo shastram jyotish prakashartham darshanam buddhiratmanah tabhyam bishak suyuktabhyam chikitsa na pradyati. So shastra is like only like a lamp, it will show only a way. You have to take ideas from it. Okay, so I interpreted, you can see in Ashtanga Hridayam, Snehapana Adhyaya, you know, Arnadatta clearly explains, Ajnada Koshte Purushe, Uttama Matra Vishe, Purvam Hrisye Sim Kalpayet, Tato Madhyamam, Tata Uttamam, Tacha Prakalpayet, Evam Madhyama Matra Vishe, Hrisye Si, Hriswa Matra Vishe, Api Hrisye Sim Prakalpayet, Ajnada Koshtehi, Bahu Kuryat, Prana Samshayam, Jeevita Samshayam, you can see. So if you don't know the Koshta, first and foremost, you give Hrisyasi Matra, followed by this the easy dose. Okay, then for Madhyama Koshta also, you give hrisyasi, then hrisyasi matra, then give the dose of madhyama koshta. Then uttama person also, uttama koshta person also, uttama agni person also, first give hrisyasi matra, then give this uttama dose. So here you see in this sloka, the word tato is mentioned. Okay, so the word tato can be interpreted as similar to that, or afterwards are followed by. You can see, first you do hrisyasi, similar, followed by mild dose, then first do hrisyasi, followed by madhyama dose, then first do hrisyasi, followed by uttama dose. So that is similar. Whereas afterwards means you can interpret, okay? So the word tataha is also mentioned in sloka. The literal meaning of tataha is moreover, furthermore, or in addition to. So the following narration can be translated as, so this is purely my opinion. You know, you may agree or you may not agree. Okay. So it can be translated as, initially the physician must administer test dose followed by hriswa matra, then madhyama matra, and then uttama matra snehapana. So if not done so, sudden administration of uttama matra can kill the patient. So this particular reference I consider as arohana snehapana, you know, reference. Okay. And one more thing, you can see Chakrapani in the first chapter of Siddhisthana, he says, if the Snehapana is administered properly according to the day, the person will get Samyak Snidhilakshanas. So he don't agree with people who gives 8th day, 9th day, because it is there. You know, some acharyas gives, you know, he quotes there. 7th day, 8th day and 9th day also they give to in order to get the Samyak Snidhilakshanas. But he says it is acharyas viruddhamaya. So acharyas never agrees, because if the physician is good, if he knows the agni and koshta of the person, if he fix the dose according to the agni and koshta of the person, definitely 7th day he will get samyak snidhilakshanas. That's what he says. That means he says, you know, if you do it properly, you get samyak snidhilakshanas 7th day. So just imagine. So the scenario is, suppose you are not increasing the dose. You are giving the dose every day the same. So you initially you started with 30 ml. You know the person digested in 3 hours. So next day also, if you give 30 ml same dose, it will digest in, you know, maybe like 2.5 hours, you know, or maybe like 3 hours only. So like that, every day if you give 30 ml, definitely it is not going to give you the Samyak Snidhilakshanas. You can try in your home also. So because that will act as a Shamana Sneha only. So it is indirectly Chakrapani says that only if you increase the dose, then only you will get Samyak Snidhilakshanas in 7 days for sure. Because the fixed dose, body will be accustomed to the fixed dose. If you are giving even 100 ml, okay, you started giving 100 ml. Every day you give 100 ml 7 days, you know, but the 100 ml will be, body will be accustomed to that. It will know that when to digest this 100 ml. So, you know, you don't get this Vata Anuloman, Dipta Agni, Varchaha, Samgatam, that Samyak Snidhilakshanas will never happen. So it is clear-cut explanation that until and then you slowly increase the dose every day, you are not going to get Samyak Snidhilakshanas in seven days. So though you didn't explain directly, this is what I understood. So in Charaka also, it is there that, you know, the Snehapana for Shodhana purpose, it is better to give in Arohana Krama. Okay. So who says first, you know, Kalyanaka Karma? Of course, Vangasana is also, I explained. This, you know, increasing the dose slowly according to the koshta and agni of the person, according to the matra, uttama, madhyama, and riswa matra, you know, under balataka snehapana. So, when you are trying to give balataka snehapana, he tells different doses for 7 days, 5 days, and 3 days, riswa, madhya, and uttama matra of balataka sneha dose. So, that is also indirect reference that we can give it, that we can take it, and we can give, you know, for arohana karma. Whereas the clear cut reference you find in Kalyana Karakam. Okay, swayam narasya sneha tatparo grita tilodbhavava kramavarditam pibet. This word kramavarditam. So slowly, gradually increase the dose every day. Okay, so ghee, medicated or non-medicated or thaila, okay, is given in specific increasing dose pattern for 3 to 7 days. Okay, according to the nature of the agni and koshta. So usually it ranges from 600 to 1200 ml in the final day. Okay. So this is, you know, according to Vangasena, this, you know, he explained about under this Balataka Sneha Matra. So practically, this I made, you know, you can easily, you can make this chart, you can understand this chart. You know, this is the dose calculation. Suppose take the example, you one person, you started Sneha Pana with 25 ml as a test dose. Suppose time taken for digestion is 2 hours. Okay, then you calculate in 24 hours how much. So quantity per hour is 12.5 ml. So if you give 25 ml, the person is digested that Sneha, that 25 ml in 2 hours, then quantity per hour is 12.5 ml. Okay, so first day it should be digested in 6 hours. Okay, then 8 hours, 10 hours, until 24 hours, because you know 3 hours is test dose, and for Mrudukoshtha, you know, the Hrishvamatra should be digested in 6 hours. We already seen it. So 12.5 into 16 is 75 ml. So that 75 ml is the next day dose, that is second day dose. So second day dose 75 ml, suppose time taken for digestion is 4 hours, then quantity per hour is 18.75 ml. So digestion in 8 hours is 18.75 into 8, that is 150 ml. So that is next dose. So like that, I can easily calculate, okay, the thing. So one more method, it is very, very, very simplistic, but this method, you may not get the proper result, but you will get some extent. So like take the example, if you are giving 30 ml dose in digestion in 3 hours, then 240 ml, 24 hours, how much it will take? Like 240 ml. So 240 ml will be digested in 24 hours. That is the last day dose. Okay. So then you divide that 240 divided by 7, then you will get the dose like 33.3 ml or 35 ml every day. Just keep on increasing it. Okay. What happens then? You know, in the seventh day, you will end up in giving 240 ml. The person will get the samyak siddhi lakshanas, but the previous method is more accurate. Okay. So once again, if you are giving in some diseases, acharyas clearly explain some special things in prameha, in other places, in other kleda vyadis. You can see, don't use the snehapana or snehadravya, which is made out of goda, anupam, amisham, kshiram and all. So it should be more roksha pradhana dravyas. Okay. So once again, we have seen fat companion or sneha anupana. Once again, anupana, why it is? So drug companion is very, very important, because why you give anupana after snehapana? It is medication whose efficacy depends on the use with the second agent, and the same drug which has little effect when used alone is called drug companion. So when you use it, the bioavailability of the medicine increases, so you get very good results. Okay, so you have given the snehapana. So I'm not going too much detail about, you know, how to give, because, you know, in the early morning, I already told you, okay, you know, already, you know, it is how to give snehapana, you know, all those things, you know, so I'm just quitting that. So what happens practical in some of the points? So sneha jirnartham kim kartum. Okay, so all these advices, you must do that. Okay, so these things we'll skip, you know that. Okay, so you know, medicated medicines commonly used, so like Indugandham. So you know, Indugandham Gratham, you can use it for, you know, any even now we have COVID, trust me, you know, I believe more than this kashayams and other thing, you know, once the, you know, fever and everything subsides, you know, Grita based medicines would work very greatly. That's what my feeling is. Then where you need more lakana. Can you hear me, ma? Peep it now, I made it big. Ma, can you see the PPT?
No, sir.
Yeah, just a second. Now you can see, no?
Yes, sir.
Can you see, ma?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So Google Tiktakam, where you need some Lakana properties. Mahatiktakam, if you see what is the difference between Tiktakam and Mahatiktakam, Mahatiktakam is a little bit more Shodhana in nature, whereas Tiktakam is a little bit more Shamana in nature. So Sukumara Kritam, where you see lots of Anulo, you know, where you see Apana Vaikunya, where Apanavata is moving up, like, you know, Arshas, Grahani, in all those conditions, it will help. So, you know, there are so many Ghee, so you know better. So I'm skipping that. So during Snehapana, practical this is. So person may say, like, you know, vomiting sensation, loss of taste, too much, you know, thirst, nausea, all those things. So you can practically, you can give him, like, you know, this Bhavana Shunti, or, you know, when he feels nausea and all, no, you can give, you know, the salt, a little bit of Nimbu Pani, mix it with salt, ask him just for taste, you know, one or two drops with salt, you know, you can apply in the, you know, tongue so that he will not feel that bad taste. Then you can give this Bhavana Shunti to remove the Hirlasa. Okay, and if he's feeling like Trishna, you know, then you can ask him to give, have some warm water, all those stuffs you can advise always. And if it is, if the person is, you know, vomiting, if he feels too much, sometimes what happens, too much vomiting, if it comes, there is no other way, he may vomit, okay? So once he has vomited, you know, next day, you know, the person is okay, then you can once again give the Snehapana that day itself. Otherwise, next day, you can give once again, maybe like adjusting the dose, okay? So once, it must be, when to terminate the Snehapana, it must be continued until you see the Samyak Snigdha Lakshanas. So basically, if you see the Samyak Snigdha Lakshanas, the main thing is, like, you know, flow, the oil or ghee floating in the toilet, okay? So basically, once again, as I said, how you are, according to the Agni and Kosha, you know, how you assess, no? Here also you can make the assessment criteria, okay? So it will be, when you make the scoring pattern and give the assessment criteria, no? It will be easy for you to, you know, pick the proper dose as well as get the Samyak Snigdha Lakshanas. So it's very simple, is you will have loose stools, okay? Diarrhea will be there, okay? In some cases, what happens, it can be constipation also, okay? So diarrhea will be there, and you will see oil. You will say, doctor, I see oil or ghee, you know, the fat substance in my toilet. That means, you know, Samyak Snigdha Lakshanas. Of course, and it can be Sneha Udvesham. You know, that is very important, Samyak Snigdha Lakshanas. You can't force the person. Why? Because, you know, after some time, he will have too much of aversion to the Sneha substance. He will say, doctor, even the sight of Sneha will make him puke, or it will make him vomit. So then you must stop it. So these two criteria, practically you keep. Ask the patient every day, do you see maximum, you know, in third day, fourth day, and all to come. So whether, like, you know, in the seventh day also depends on the person. So whether the person is, you know, having ghee or oil in the closet, or whether he is having Sneha Udvega, all those stuff. So these two things, you keep it in your mind, you ask the patient, then once you come across these symptoms, stop the Snehapana, okay? So it is Vata Anulomniyam, you know, the Samyak Snigdha Lakshanas, why they mentioned, we think Vata Anulomniyam just for normal passing of flat as we see. But practically, I'm telling you, when you give proper Snehapana, no, in the sixth day, seventh day and all, no, you can literally ask the patient, he will say, doctor, somehow, you know, for the past 2 days, I'm having lots of this farting, too much of gas is going out of body, and you know, it will have a different fat smell, that ketone smell will be there. Ask him whether your flour, this farting is smelling. He will say, you know, it's a different smell, is doctor, and he will say lots of farting happens. This one also you can consider as Samyak Snigdha Lakshanas. So Vata Anulomniyam means it's not like just passing the this you know, gas. It is when you are in the sixth day, seventh day, and all, when you do proper Snehapana, the person will have too much of Vata movement, downward Vata movement, and there will be some typical, you know, ketone smell will be there. You can always ask this practically, okay? So now I will go like, possible reasoning of Samyak Snigdha Lakshanas. What happens when you take the ghee for 5 days, 3 days, or 7 days? The pure fat, you know, now we are entering into the mode of action. So like what happens when you take them? What really body does it? Okay. So Vata Lunamanyam is dearranged Vata dosha causes abnormal stool consistency, giving rise to flatus abscess. So when there is too much of Ruksha and Vata, always Vata Anulomanyam don't happen. Vata Anulomanam. So when you give the Snehapana, this phenomena is reversed. Okay. So once this phenomena is reversed, automatically Vata Anulomanam happens. Okay. Then Agni Deepti. This is impaired Vata in various chronic diseases causes dearranging of Pitta and Kapha, which causes Mandagni. By Sneha administration, the dearranged Vata is taken care of, and by that Pitta, Kapha and Agni becomes normal. Okay. So one more thing, what could happen now? In the initial days, the leptin hormone, you know, it is a hunger hormone, would have gone up, making the person feel full. So when you eat food, no, the leptin comes into the place. So that makes you this leptin makes you full. Okay, in obese patient, this is what happening. They don't feel full because the leptin is not secreted or some problem in leptin mechanism. So what happens in the initial days, you know, after some days, the body will be in position to handle the high fat. In the initial days, the leptin hormone would have gone up, making it the person feel full. So in the initial third day, fourth day and all, no? So the person, you can see, he won't feel like he's having food. He will not have appetite. He will have very tiredness, weakness. All those things will be there with the person. Why? Because there is very less food. When you give Snehapana, the carbohydrates are, you know, they are the instant energy. So carbohydrate is not available. We are giving only soup and yosham and other things. So basically the person, the electrolytes goes for imbalance. That is the reason why person feels tired, weak, lethargy, all those things he feel because of less food, less carbs. Okay. And ketone body sets in. So these are the symptoms. So the initial days, you know, the leptin would have gone up to making the person feel full. So after some days, the body will be in position to handle the high fat with the help of ghrelin. So ghrelin hormone, once again, hunger hormone. So when ghrelin is there, then you will get appetite. Hence the improved appetite. So this could be also one of the reason why this hormone mechanism could be the reason why this Agni Deepti happens. Okay, then energy production. Okay, so now we are entering into the what happens, you know, when you know, have this Snehapana. So basically, okay, what happens when you eat? Normally, most of our food has carbohydrates. So carbs are instant energy. You know that, okay? So when you eat normal food like rice or anything, okay, it is immediately, you can see nowadays the obesity or you can see we are rice eaters basically, and they modified our rice. You know, that's the reason why nowadays you see many people are having so much of tummy, so much of, you know, cardiovascular disease. I believe it is nothing to do with fat. It is, I believe strongly, it is something to do with the food, rice and rice items that we are eating. We have become so much of rice eaters, and the rice, they have changed. They made it more sweet. The more carbs we eat, that much bad for us. So immediately what happens after we eat, carbohydrates are converted into glucose, and insulin helps glucose from bloodstream to get into cells. Glycolysis happens. Okay. So in the cell, what happens once the glycolysis starts in the cell, what happens? This glucose is converted into pyruvate. Okay, so you've taken the glucose and it is gone inside. The glycoinsulin acts on it and goes to the cell. Okay, then it is converted into this pyruvate, and this pyruvate is converted into acetyl COA molecule and sent to the citric acid cycle to generate energy, that is adenosine triphosphate. So without adenosine, you can say ATP is life itself. So without this adenosine triphosphate, there is no energy production. The cell will die. So every day there are so much of this energy is produced with the help of adenosine triphosphate. So glucose enters there, it changes into pyruvate and enters into the, you know, citric acid cycle, and you know the adenosine triphosphate is it is generated. So you get the energy. So what happens when you don't eat the carbs? So once again, when you eat every day, our brain cells work hard to understand what is happening around us. So we have to coordinate so many things, you know, the brain has to work, it has to hear, see, whatnot. So brain constantly needs the energy. Okay. So this energy is provided by this ATP. Okay. So the brain cells receives information, everything he does, like a motherboard. So it needs constant energy. That energy is provided by this ATP molecules. And mainly you get this ATP, you know, the energy production from carbohydrates. So what happens now in the scenario of Snehapana? Now the carbs are not there. Only fat is there. So what will happen? How, you know, energy should be produced now? The brain needs energy for, you know, like a current is necessary for the computer to work. Now, if there is no current, then the computer will die. So now what is the, now we need to find the different source of energy. Okay, like maybe like we have a backup or something. So that different source of energy is, you know, the fat. So what happens, once again, you know, I skip that, you know, the energy production, I in the simplistic manner, I explained it. Okay, so what happens when you take more fat? So during snehapana, what happens, your the carbs are zero or very nil or less. Okay, so body needs more energy, brain needs more energy, and ATP is not produced properly because of less carbohydrate. So ketogenesis sets in. So when you take high fat, okay, what happens? The body goes into ketogenesis mode. Okay, so this ketosis or ketosis mode. What is ketosis? Physiology of ketosis. Ketogenesis is a metabolic pathway that produces ketone bodies. Okay, ketone bodies are energy producers, but they don't work like glucose. Though they produce ATP, they produce differently, and they are different than the glucose energy that we will see. Okay, so ketogenesis is a metabolic pathway that produces ketone bodies, which provides an alternative form of energy to the body. So when carbohydrate energy is not available, so this ketosis sets in and ketone bodies are produced, which provides the energy to the body, including brain. So how it occurs, every day it occurs. Ketogenesis occurs in day-to-day life. For example, during strenuous exercise and fasting. So what happens during snehapana? It's like fasting only. We are not eating anything, only fat, and we are taking more fat. What happens when you take more fat? Okay, so when enough glucose is not available to generate this acetyl-CoA, and it is generated and regulated from oxidated fatty acids, and from that ATP is generated. So this ketosis happens. Now due to this ketosis, you know, the subcutaneous fats, the stored energy is stimulated. Now, the you know, that is the reason why when you take snehapana, the person loses weight. When you take snehapana, the person feels tired and weak. When you take snehapana, the sugar level goes down. Why? Because the carbs are not there. The insulin, no need to work so much. So automatically, when the person follows proper snehapana and shodhana, trust me, you don't need any medications for diabetes. Okay? So because of less glucose availability, the ketone bodies are produced and the energy production started. Okay? So most organs and tissues can use ketone bodies as a source of energy, mainly the brain. Now you understand why ghee is mentioned in this psychological diseases, because ghee can produce these ketone bodies, and these ketone bodies energy production can easily travel to the brain. Okay, and they are very, very important for the brain function. That is the reason why first and foremost, when the child is born, we give the ghee, because directly it can go enter the blood brain barrier. Okay, so fatty acids are used by heart as well as these ketone bodies, used by the fatty acids, from fatty acids, these ketone bodies are produced, so all the organs are used. So what happens, benefits? So in humans, ketone, so during snehapana, this is what happening. Ketogenesis sets in, ketone bodies are produced. That's why, you know, you can see after fourth day or fifth day of snehapana, there will be smell of ketone bodies. The person's sweat or the mouth, no, you can simply literally see the ketone smell. And even in the toilet, when they fart, no, the ketone smell will be there. So in humans, ketone bodies are the only additional source of brain energy after glucose. Thus, the use of ketone bodies by the brain could be significant evolutionary development that occurs in the parallel with brain development in humans. See how, you know, important these ketone bodies for the brain development. Okay, so here, readers, I would like to, excuse me. So the slides, you know, is very less. I'm going to continue it with my book, because see, I'm writing a book. I'm almost finished it. So these contents I put in my book, okay, and I'm going to publish it recently. So some of the contents, and yesterday night only Dr. Swami told to, rather than giving too much of classic, he wanted me to tell all these things. So I could not prepare the entire slides. So please bear with me. I apologize for that. Whereas I go through from my, text, okay?
Okay, sir.
Is that okay, Ma?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So if you see the ketogenesis, so I told you when you take the Snehapana, the ketogenesis sets in. Okay. So during Snehapana, there is too much of fat intake, there is less carb intake. What happens? The ketogenic diet. So this is what happening, I told, when you take the Snehapana, you are into the ketogenic mode. So the ketogenic diet or ketone bodies production clinically proven in controlling epilepsy seizures. Okay. So how it is best? The effect of ketogenic diet in epilepsy may be due to the increased availability of the beta hydroxybutyrate, a ketone body. So this, you know, there are different names of ketone bodies are there. One ketone body name is this beta hydroxybutyrate. So this is stimulated when you take Snehapana. You know, when you take Snehapana, the ketogenesis is sets in. Could be, you know, this beta hydroxybutyrate would have stimulated. So that could be one of the reason why why in epilepsy or adatto abhinivesham or even other psychiatric diseases, they're told to give us a key, because this ketone bodies works in brain level, and the Snehapana triggers this ketone bodies. Okay. Then once again, these are really research based, and it is available in various books, and you can see it in in the internet also. So once again, when you take more fat, what happens? Beneficial changes in the brain energy profile have been observed in subjects who are on ketogenic diet. Okay, so you can see, because when the person is under ketogenic diet, there are lots of changes happens in the brain. Okay, so when in the brain, what happens? One particular thing happens is cerebral hypometabolism. If you see that depression, okay, anxiety, mania, and bipolar diseases, what happens? There is a cerebral hypometabolism is always there. This is proved in studies. So the metabolism of the brain is not good, and cerebral hypometabolism is there in people, those who suffer from depression, mania, bipolar illness, and even Alzheimer's and Parkinson's. So the neurotransmitters are not able to transport the signal processed by the brain to the target organ. So brain, though it is producing neurotransmitters, but it is not able to transport this signal to the target organ. So this is reversed, okay? This is reversed by ketogenesis diet. This is reversed by ketogenesis or the Snehapana, okay? So safely we can conclude that,
Excuse me, sir.
Yeah, ma.
Sir, end your PPT, sir. Stop sharing. You give that option as stop sharing your screen.
Oh, now I don't have PPT, ma.
No, sir.
End PPT.
You give that end PPT, sir.
Oh, I have to give it, ma.
Yes, sir.
And then escape.
Now it is okay, ma?
Yes, sir.
Okay. All right. So this is, we can assume, we'll safely say, when you do the Snehapana and Shodhana, that is Deepana Pachana, Snehana, Swedana, Shodhana, and Payadikrama, almost it takes 11 to 21 days. So Mridukoshta, even Mridukoshta, if we say it is 11 days, or the maximum it can take 21 days. So during this period, the intake of carbs are drastically reduced. You can see our diet is simply fat only, very, very less carbs. So basically, body increases the ketone body production. And because of this ketone body production, lots of changes happens in our body, the brain function, all those things improves. Okay. And it is assumption only, increase of fat increases obesity like that, but it is only assumption. It is not true at all. Okay. The carbohydrate is the biggest culprit. That is the reason why the obesity, you give Snehapana, the person loses weight. Okay. The fat will never make you fat. Okay. So on the contrary, the recent studies have proved that high fat diet regime can help in reducing weight. Okay. And one more thing, it is a known fact that a diet with high glycemic load is associated with the development of cardiovascular diet. So recently they found out, as I said, carbs are the culprits. So the diet with, you know, high glycemic load, always bad for the heart, not this simple our Snehapana. So there is no question of Snehapana causing heart disease. Okay. Once again, sugar consumption is always positively associated with the cancer. Okay, so during Snehapana, we are avoiding all those stuffs. So it can, you know, help, you know, to take care of the, even sugar. Okay. So that is the reason why, what happens when you, during a Snehapana, why this LDL cholesterol is, you know, goes down, or sometimes, you know, the LDL cholesterol may go a little bit high only. Okay. So it is true that saturated fat can increase low density lipoprotein, that is LDL, and certain other risk factors such as inflammation. It is unclear whether saturated fat increases the risk of heart disease. For example, a 2014 review of 32 studies that included 27 randomized control trials involving over 6,50,000 people found no association between saturated fat intake and heart disease. So you can proudly say Snehapana will never harm the person. Okay. So now we have seen about ketogenesis. Now one more thing we'll see now about autophagy, lipophagy and Snehapana. So this is also happens when you take Snehapana. So when you are in Snehapana, as I told, the ketogenesis happens. So the ketone bodies are how they are helpful, we have seen. Okay. So when the body is under starvation mode, of course, when you are taking during the Snehapana, what happens? Body undergoes into the starvation mode, okay, because of less food. So this mechanism called autophagy triggers in. The autophagy sets in. Auto means self. Phagy means literally eat. So cells eat their own contents. You know, your cell is made out of different organelles, right? So in certain timings, what happens, this cell has to take care of itself, because every day it produces so many new cells and it kills so many old cells. So if this process has to be happened properly, because if the old cells are not killed, or if the bad rogue organelles are not taken care of, our body will fall ill or we may die. So this autophagy mechanism sets in, the cell eats its own organelles in order to keep the body healthy. So this mechanism, this autophagy mechanism happens during Snehapana. Okay. So if the cell feels, I will explain you how it is, how it happens. So if the cell feels that if its own cytoplasmic organelle are problematic, then that cell will get rid of those problematic organelle by fusing with lysosome. So, you know, different organelles are there, like mitochondria, you know, these, that, so many organelles. So in any one of that organelle is a rogue or creating problem, what it does, this one will fuse with that particular cell, will fuse with the lysosome, and it will eliminate that, you know, rogue fellow. So that is called autophagy. Okay, this autophagy can be triggered in day-to-day life, and it is every day it is happening. When you do exercise, autophagy happen. When you do fasting, autophagy happen, because ketogenesis indirectly triggers autophagy. In every day it does happen, but during Snehapana it happens more. We'll see what is the best thing about autophagy, why everybody must try this. According to me, at least everyone should try this Snehapana at least, you know, once a year, definite, because if you see the, you know, how wonderfully it, you know, it is acting on the body, it's unbelievable. So this autophagy, you know, sets in more when you are in Snehapana, though it happens day to day life. But during Snehapana, it happens more. When it happens more, it is very good for the body and mind. Okay. So basically, every day in day-to-day life, what happens? The autophagy forms the autophagosome. It's like a, you know, bubble-like structure. So once this autophagosome is formed from the cell, so it goes and it attaches with the different bad fellows. Okay. Like degraded proteins, organelles, okay, lipid droplets. This is what happens when you take the ghee. Even the ghee goes inside the cell as a lipid droplets. Okay, so there it triggers the autophagosome. So when the lipid droplets are more, autophagosome must be triggered. Okay, so it engulfs these things and clears them. Okay, so it is basically, it is three types. I don't want to go much in it. I have written more in my book, like, you know, this chevron mediated micro autophagy and macro autophagy. So we'll see this, what happens, you know, this about this micro autophagy, this what happening in a snehapana. So macro autophagy is happening during snehapana. Macro autophagy is genetically programmed, evolutionarily conserved catabolic process. You can see catabolic process that degrades cellular proteins and damaged or excessive organelles through the formation of double membrane structure known as autophagosome. So this is what is happening, okay, during autophagy. Okay, this is what is happening during. Amma, can you see me? Hello?
Yes, sir.
You can see me, Noma?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so this autophagosome is triggered during snehapana. Okay, so this macro autophagy, you have different things like why I'm saying all these things, because I will just explain how they are connected to snehapana. So mitophagy is bulk degradation of mitochondria. Reticuloplasty, bulk degradation of endoplasmic reticulum in the lysosome. Then nucleophagy, degradation of nucleus in lysosome. And lipophagy, degradation of lipids in lipid droplets. This is what happens when we take the snehapana. It goes to the body, ketogenesis sets in, it triggers autophagy, and inside the cell, these lipid droplets are going inside. The lipophagy is triggered with the help of snehapana. Okay? So what happens once this lipophagy is triggered? Okay, so recently a close relationship between autophagic activity and lipid metabolism has been recognized. So snehapana, when you take it, is nothing but lipid metabolism. You take so much of fat, right? What is really happening inside? So it goes to the, everybody knows about, you know, it goes autophagosome and autophagy, and you know it helps, you know, later I will tell you how it is helpful to the body. So this lipid overload triggers this autophagy mechanism, so it's good for the body. But if you are keeping on giving more than 7 days, what happens? It just reverses it. So autophagy will start, you know, killing others rather than acting good. So if you give within 7 days, in, you know, when you give more fat and other thing, it triggers autophagy, body will be all right and you get benefit. But if you give beyond that, the mechanism is reversed and the body will be in danger. How clever our acharyas, you know, that's the reason why they said maximum of 7 days. Okay, so how you can induce autophagy? I said intermittent fasting or fasting. So this is what happens when you take the ghee. So intermittent fasting increases neuronal autophagy in cortical neurons and Purkinje cells, which are important neurons and nerve cells critical to brain function. So when the autophagy sets in due to less carbs and more fat due to ketogenesis, this is what happening. So the Purkinje cells are stimulated, and which is very, very important for neurological functions. Okay, so that's why, you know, when you do snehapana, it is best for you know, brain. Then once again, because of this ketogenic diet and because of more fat intake, so the ketone bodies reduces LDL cholesterol. Okay, once again, you know, here I want to tell one thing. In LDL cholesterol, no, usually in the blood test, no, they test only the circulating LDL particles, but they don't, you know, basically test the entire LDL particles, entire LDL load. So when you take, I have did the study on that. So when you take the entire LDL load, always after snehapana, during snehapana, it is showing less only. Whereas only if you take LDL particles, and it, you know, in some cases it is showing more, but this, you know, circulating LDL particle is not a risk factor for heart disease. Only the entire load of LDL in the blood is risk factor for heart disease, which is less during snehapana. So definitely snehapana will not cause heart disease. I can vouch for it. I can provide the data. Okay, so this you know, increased fat and ketogenic diet, you know, reduces the activity of this TOR kinase in the hippocampus of the brain. and this TOR act as a, this is a protein TOR, okay? TOR act as an autophagy blocker, so the ketogenic diet may be able to increase autophagy by decreasing TOR levels. Okay, and once again, next, exercise. Of course, exercise also increases this autophagy mechanism. So next we'll see what happens, benefits of autophagy. This is what happening when you take Snehapana, because regulates cellular mitochondria, which improves energy production in the body, protects the nervous system and the immune system. Okay, then protects against metabolic stress, encourages growth of new cells, especially those in brain and heart tissue, enhancing cognitive functions and protecting against the heart disease. Then helps improve digestive function by repairing and restoring the gut lining, and helps to protect our genes by maintaining the integrity and stability of our DNA. Genetic links have emerged between autophagy defects and cancer, providing increased support for concept that autophagy is a Bonfort tumor suppressor pathway. Okay. So with this, though they gave me only 2 hours, sorry, I took a little bit 15 minutes, more, right? So with this, I will do concluding remarks. Dear viewers and students, I didn't cover, after some of that, what happens, Atisnigdha Lakshanas, Asinigdha Lakshanas, Sneha Vapath. You know, I have scientifically written really what happens if you give excessive fat, over the period of time, how it is, why those symptoms are happening, what could be the reason in the biochemistry level, what is happening inside the body, what could be the real reason of Atisnigdha Lakshanam, Asnigdha Lakshanam, everything, I have covered in my book, okay? And I'll be launching, and this is my contribution to Ayurveda. I'm not going to sell it. I'm going to distribute it freely so that people can read it, and they can give their. I really welcome all your opinion, though you are all my students or maybe viewers, because every day we read from people, even from children. So I'm really, really hoping forward to hear your comments about my presentation as well as my book. So I covered those topics in the book. Why? Because this is a very big topic. Okay. So with this, I would like to give some conclusion. Okay. So an ideal quantity of lipid stimulate autophagy, and autophagy counteracts the lipotoxicity through mitochondrial quality control. More than the required quantity of lipid can reverse the autophagy mechanism and will induce lipid toxicity to cell. Lipid toxicity is highly dangerous, and eventually it kills the cell. The conflicting result may be attributed to difference in cell types, observation period, okay, etc. So high fat, more than the required quantity, can down-regulate autophagy by the reducing autophagosome lysosome function, whereas a low fat administration less than the requirement of the person may not trigger the autophagy. This could be the reason why the dose of Snehapana is fixed after studying the requirement of the person by understanding the Agni and Koshta. The diet during, after and before Snehapana contains low carbs and high protein, and Snehapana is pure fat administration. This mechanism triggers autophagy lipophagy, which acts against disease formation. This mechanism also stimulates the immune system, and properly working immune system is always important for disease prevention. This is the reason why Shodhana is advised in different season as a preventive measure. High quantity of fat also stimulates Purkinje cells through lipophagy, and which these Purkinje cells are important for the normal brain function. Administration of Snehapana may reduce the insulin levels, and the reduced insulin increases the secretion of glucagon. The increased glucagon levels triggers autophagy. This reduction in insulin and increased glucagon is always beneficial in counteracting obesity, diabetes mellitus, polycystic ovarian syndrome, and high serum triglyceride levels. Restriction of autophagy through overexpression of ATG7 also can restore insulin level back to normal and improve glucose tolerance. The study shows that high fat intake always reduces the triglycerides levels, and only small increase in LDL or no increase at all. This has been proved from various studies of different Ayurveda universities. A rise in cholesterol during keto or low carb eating may be related to losing weight. It's been known for decades that major weight loss can lead to a temporary rise in LDL cholesterol. The process of making ketones requires a compound called acetyl-CoA, which is a precursor to cholesterol. So if it is increased, don't worry. You know, it will increase. It's a simple physiological process. Okay. And it has been well documented that SDLDL has a greater atherogenic potential than that of LDL. See, in the labs, they don't test at all this SDLDL. They test only LDL. See where the nexus is going on. Okay, so potential than that of LDL subfractions, and that SDLDL cholesterol proportion is better marker for prediction of cardiovascular disease than that of total LDL cholesterol. Okay, so whenever you are doing Snehapana study, no, try to do that. Definitely, you know, it won't be increased. Then the high fat intake may decrease TOR kinase, which is found in hippocampus of the brain. The increased TOR kinase always block the autophagy formation in chronic disease. So Snehapana could reduce the TOR kinase formation in the brain. By that, the autophagy is induced, and in turn, autophagy helps to fight chronicity of the disease. Snehapana could help in the formation of Belsin-1 protein, which is found not active in people who are prone to cancer. Activation of Belsin-1 protein by Snehapana could possibly prevent the cancer formation in those who doesn't have that protein. Next, cell death occurs prematurely in old age because of dysfunctional mitochondria. Snehapana might induce mitophagy, which in turn help in removal of dysfunctional mitochondria that would generate mutational DNA during old age. Postponement of old age and preserving the youth is one of the main functions of Snehapana. Next, Parkinson's disease are provoked by mutations of PINK1 or Parkin, some of which can result in defects in mitophagy. Snehapana induced autophagy could help in the formation of proper mitochondria. Proper formation of mitochondria in brain cells is very important for the production of dopamine, which is impaired in chronic Parkinson's. Okay, so with this, I would like to conclude my session, and I once again thank the principal and the organizers and my beloved friend Dr. Kenda Dhamat and all the organizers for giving me this opportunity, and I welcome your questions. I try my level best to answer them. Hope you enjoyed my session. Feel free to talk to me. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. It was a very wonderful session, sir, on understanding biochemistry of Snehana to the level of cellular level, sir, which we doesn't get in any textbooks, sir. Today it was a very wonderful session on Snehana understanding and practical utility of Snehana and how what Snehana does to our body when we take do Snehapana. Thank you very much, sir, for this wonderful session, detailed session. Sir, there are some queries, sir.
Yeah, I'm sorry, I didn't cover Sadhya Sneha. I didn't cover, then I didn't cover this Vicharna Sneha and all, because 2 hours is not enough. So maybe sir, next time, I'll try to cover, so I'm sorry yes, about sir. It. Huh? Yes.
From Dr. Sureka, question is, Mrudu Tama Koshta should get Snehata in less than duration that of the Mrudu Koshta. Yes or no, sir? Like it happens like that or no?
Yeah, Mrudu Tama Koshta. Yes, that's a very good question. Actually, that slide was wrong, Ma. Actually, I put it upside down. Her question is correct. She should get less. That person okay. should get less in less day only. I'm sorry okay. about it. That slide is wrong. Yes, she is correct. Okay. He should get within less time only.
Thank you, sir. Next question is from Dr. Prema. Understanding of Snehapana mentioned in Amavata Chikitsa Sutra is Shodhana, it should be taken as Shodhananga or Shamana Sneha. Applies to what, sir?
See, Amavata, both it applies. Okay, so Ruksha is first, as I said, Snehapana can be given in conditions in Prameha, all those Kledatu also. So in Amavata, there is a Kledatum also there. Okay. So first we need to follow the Ruksha Chikitsa. Once, if you find out that there is no Ama, but Amavata always there will be Ama. Some extent if there is less Ama, if the person is fit for Shodhana, And if you believe that, you know, it can, because see, sometimes Amavata patient can be with obesity. Okay, that can cripple their walking and everything. So like, though they said Gritam cannot be given, Snehana cannot be given, but always, as I said, if you can take some of the dravyas which lakana quality and give it to the person, that time you can use it as a shodhana, because Vamana can help in that. Whereas, you know, once this is done, where you see like, you know,
of cow related to the Grita uses.
That is there, you know, in Sushruta also, ma. But once again, let me see and tell you, ma, properly. Okay.
Okay.
And it is there, ma. And I don't know the exact reference, ma. But okay. I'll tell. Okay. But okay. It is there in our text.
Yes. Thank you, sir. Next question, sir. Significance of Purusha Snigdhata and Pak Snigdhata. Sometimes there will be Purusha Snigdhata, but no Pak Snigdhata. Can we take it as Samyak Snigdha, sir?
You can take it, but the thing is, Tvak Snigdhata very, very difficult to assess. Okay, but as I said, if you give proper Snehapana, 100% you will get Purusha Snigdhata. Okay, definite. There is no question about it. Okay, that's why, you know, I said that is, you should keep it that one as a main criteria. Sneha Utvegam. Snehautvegam and Purisha Snigdhata. So these two, among all the criteria mentioned, you know, because all other things, like, you know, this Tvaksa Snigdhata and all, very difficult to measure. Okay, otherwise we should have like some, we can measure with the help of some, you know, skin specialists. You know, the sebaceous gland, how you should do it is with the help of sebaceous secretion. So like you need to study, you know, whether before Snehapana, how much sebaceous secretion gland, how much secretion is happening, and after Snehapana, how much secretion has increased. That is what Tvaksa Snigdhata is. Okay. So definitely when you give proper quantity, ma, Purusha Snigdhata will definitely happen. And you, that if not also, Snehadvaikam will be there.
Thank you, sir. The last, one more question, sir. How, yes, from Dr. Seema. How can we explain result of Snehapana in autoimmune disorders like GB syndrome?
Which one, ma?
How can we explain result of Snehapana in autoimmune disorders like GB syndrome?
Yes, as I said, it's basically, you know, when you know, I already explained, we can explain through autophagy mechanism and lipophagy mechanism, because they do change, they act as immune modulators. When you trigger the autophagy and lipophagy, they act as immune modulators. Okay, so through that mechanism, we can definitely say, you know, how Snehapana works in that.
Okay, sir. Thank you. Next question, sir. Sir, in pediatric age group if Aravana Snehapana is given, ketogenesis may cause Krushata. How will you substantiate, sir?
Pediatric, we don't give Noma Arohana. We give always Vicharna Pam. Because Bala, okay. Vrida and all, it's clearly stated in our text, you know, we'll give them Vicharna Sneha only. Okay? So if somebody is practicing in pediatric, no. For them, Shamana Sneha would be better. Okay? And if you are planning to do Shodhana, do it in a Vicharna method. That is better for them. Because it can put them under serum. Maybe pediatric obesity, you can go for Shodhananga pure Achapana. Okay, in other cases where nutrition is very important for children, and you know, we cannot take a risk on that. So that's why Vicharna Sneha is mentioned. Definitely children will not drink ghee and alma.
Yes. Next question, sir. How long we can continue Shamana Sneha, sir? Like we will be scheduling Shamana Sneha, sir. But for how long?
Yeah, practically there is no, you know, they didn't mention, but various, according to various experts and other things, no, until the disease subsides or until you develop, as the disease subsides or until you develop that aversion. Because it's a small dose, but after some time you will definitely feel that aversion. You go and take it. These criteria we can follow.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Next question, sir. How to assess the quality of ghee available in market, sir?
That's what I said, you know. We have to laboratorily we must check, as I said, either it's a butter oil or it's an original ghee, you know, As I said, now not only that, ma, they are mixing with the buffalo oil, this one and all. Whatever Grita quality said, it is a Gavyam Gritam. I forgot to tell that the quality of Gavyam Gritam only they told. You know, whatever Dhi Smriti Medagani, that is for Gavyam Gritam. Whereas in the market, what we are getting, it's a mixed and different species of cows. So, you know, as I said, you know, I'm against of this, ma. And that could be also one of the reason why, you know, people say sometimes Ayurveda is not working. We have lots of, you know, hindrance, lots of difficulties. You know, imagine one simple thing, how to collect the dravya. It should be collected in the wild form. Nowadays, most of the dravyas we are getting in, we are growing it. Acharya said, don't take the medicine which you are grown. The medicine should be grown wild. So like with this, if we can do this much, just imagine when we get to the original things, we will do miracles. So, you know, we have to, you know, nowadays it is picking up, you know, in North India, even like everywhere, there are goshalas are there. Now they are, you know, you can see, I forgot, this is the original, you can see the Deshi ghee. You can see the color, ma. This I forgot to, you know, I didn't know how to show it. You see the color. It is not yellow. Yellow is, if wherever you see yellow color ghee, no, that is butter oil. That is not a Gritam. You see, this is, you know, from one of the Goshala, I got it, one Swamiji gave it to me. Just look at the color and the aroma is completely different, ma. So, you know, where you get is, you know, not good, actually. If you want to check the quality, of course, only laboratorically we can do it.
Okay, thank you, sir. Next question, sir. Basic consideration before practice of PK in foreign patients, panchakarma in foreign patients, like time, dose, patya, ahara kalpanas, etc.
Yes. One thing I must tell you, they are better than us. I'm not putting our Indians down, but trust me, they want to follow it. They are, you know, they respect us so much, especially, you know, I get lots of even allopathy doctors. They come and study with me. They come and even do the, you know, if you say them properly, you have to explain them first. First and foremost, you have to explain them about their prakriti and vikriti. They expect that, you know, they come prepared. It's not like our, you know, our people, okay, you go and take nothing like that. It don't work out like that. You have to take a detailed history. You have to talk to them. You have to see prakriti. You have to tell vikriti. Then you have to prepare them. You have to explain them, you know, what will happen. Second day, third day, what are the symptoms, side effects, what to expect, what is the outcome. Okay. And if you explain and follow, you know, like you, they don't even love to compromise. So like diet means exactly what it is said in the text, you know. So once you explain them, once you properly do things, explain everything to them, they just go. So foreigners, if you are getting foreigners, make sure that you consult properly, take the detailed history, okay, and do Prakriti Vikriti Pariksha and tell your ideas and how you are going to execute that ideas and what is the outcome. You have to tell all these things, then you will be successful.
Thank you, sir. Last question from Dr. Ashwini, sir. Can you put some light on the difference of opinion regarding the Shodhananga Sneha Matra in Charaka 12-hour dosage and in
Ashtangaraja
24-hour dosage?
See, as I said, that is, you know, both like for Shodhananga, Charaka says Madhyama Matra. For whereas Shamananga, he says Uttama Matra. Whereas Ashtanga Hridayakara, just he says opposite. Okay. So frankly speaking, I don't know, ma. But practically, for Shodhananga purpose, Uttama Matra is best. Okay. So that you get practically, you get good results with that. For Shamana purpose, Uttama, if you give, you know, the person may not tolerate. So Madhyama, you can go there. Whereas for Brahmana, Avara Matra is to conclude this.
Thank you, sir. From Dr. Rashmi,
Uttama
sir.
Matra, sorry, Uttama Matra always digest in 24 hours. Whereas Madhyama Matra, half of it, okay? 12 hours.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. From Dr. Rashmi, in ketogenic diet, 60% fat, 30% protein, 10% carbs is necessary. but Acharya has mentioned Peya, Vilepi, how can we adjust this ratio so that ketogenesis will happen properly?
I said, you know, in that, not only that, they gave Mamsaras also. You can see, not only Peya, Vilepi, Mamsaras also, they said. So once again, you see the condition of the patient. So suppose you are treating an obesity person, he need very less carbs, or Madhumeha person, there you give very, very less carbs. Whereas a person who is strength, there you give more carbs related. So like mandam or in a rice brew like that. So you decide according to the patient.
Yes.
So ketogenesis will set in.
Yes, sir. Some people are asking, sir, may we get your book online from Dr. Seema?
Like maybe Seema, I'll tell you. Okay, thanks for that question. The first edition, as I said, you know, I'm going to bring some 250 or 300 books. I'm planning to send it to institutions, HODs and PGs. Okay, so like Swami is there, like that, you know, my friends. And I want to get the feedback from them, you know, how it is, because I still believe that I have to grow more, you know. I don't know really whether, you know, I'm the best person to launch a book and all. So I still want to know from where it's really good, then I will publish it for money. Okay, that it will be very nominal price, and if God's grace, if God's willing is there, hopefully in online it will be available. Always, you know, in the book itself, I am giving my email ID and everything. They can contact me personally. I will supply it to them. No problem.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you for the wonderful session. Now I welcome our HOD, sir, for a vote of thanks.
Hello.
Hello.
May I audible?
Yeah, you are audible. Yeah. Your picture is not showing, doctor.
Hello.
Sir, before that, some people are asking my contact. Can you just tell me my sir. Contact number?
It will definitely, sir. We will provide on the input here itself.
Yeah, okay.
In question bank. Okay. Yeah. Anyone you can make? You can this one. No? Yeah. Give sir number to students and others. Okay. Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon. Thank you. Thank you once again, Dr. Swami, for inviting me and giving me this opportunity.
It's my great privilege to provide opportunity. Rather than opportunity, we gain a lot of knowledge from your side, sir. Once again, it's my sincere gratitude to convey my thanks to the such a wonderful personality. Though you are my best friend, but still, it's my privilege to invite you, and as well as my students and even other participants. They are very happy to hear you about your enormous and vast knowledge in the biochemical assay and to better understanding the concept of Neapana. Yes, basically, the PG students, they require the understanding of Neapana on modern parameters. Of course, it's whether it's needed or not needed, that's a secondary thing. To one, the point for a proper understanding of Neapana, what personally I feel, unless until there is no evidence-based approach, accept our science. What the job today you have did, it's really wonderful and amazing. Really, personally, I say thanks, and even on behalf of our esteemed institution, TGMC Ballari, and on behalf of our principal madam and Gangir sir, and my well-known staffs and my PG scholars. Once again, I thank you very much, sir. After completion of this pandemic, we would like to call you and invite you for offline session. Yeah,
sure.
We have promised together. Okay, we can work together constructively in the betterment and upliftment of the science and as well as our students. Once again, thank you very much, sir.
Thank you very much. Take care.
Okay.
Bye.
Thank you, sir.
ಸಾರಿ ನೀವು ಕೈ ಮಾಡ್ತಿದ್ದೆ.